Welcome to the STABcast, a podcast dedicated to Star Wars Legion.
Hi kids, my name's Lauren. I hope you're doing very well today. We're going to sing a song about good manners, like saying thank you and please. It's called Be Polite. Are you ready? When someone gives you something, it's good to say thank you. Say thank you.
Welcome, cadets and commanders, to the STABcast, the Sun Spirit Tactical Attack Brigade Star Wars Legion podcast. I'm LJ, Robo Legs Pena, with Ryan, Super Commando Sawoski, Ben, Capo Fowler, Will, Vigo Heim, and Tim, where is the spice? Hannon, what are we talking about today?
You know, I enjoy that mine got a little extra flair. That's good.
You did. That's nice. That's
the spice.
Stranger danger, what's happening?
I'm the spice.
Speaking of Robo Legs, can we get Spider Legs Maul? I really want Spider Legs Maul. Like, I want all the Spider Legs.
I want him on, like, the middle, the little base with the, you know, vehicle base.
Yes, I want the vehicle base. I want it to be,
it'll be a do-back situation. He'll stick out super far. You're right.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, if we're going to put him on a notched base, that means he's going to have firing arcs. Which is a good thing he's in CIS and not Republic, because if it was Republic, we'd have a Jedi with, like, weak point side.
Yeah. He's got weak point Obi-Wan Kenobi and Strafe.
Oh, goodness. Well, this week on the 93rd episode of the STABcast, we have preparations for Adepticon for most of us, but not all of us. Invader League comes again for some of us, and then the Shadow Conspiracy's in the news! And more, probably.
The news?
I don't know.
What there it is, Will. I was waiting on it.
The news!
Yay.
Later. First, our regularly sponsored... Ben, why haven't you played this game?
Listen, I've been very busy. No, I was waiting on the snails. I was waiting for the snails because I didn't want to practice a list I wasn't taking.
Oh, these bus tires feel great. Good.
really? You have a whole other army that you could play, but you're like, no, I'm not going to play any other army. Which we know this is just a thinly veiled excuse for Ben to blame Will. But anyway, continue.
Actually, I had class last weekend, so that means I didn't get any weekend play in. I've been writing papers. Like, you know, stuff is getting serious. I've got, I think, 3 more classes within the semester because we meet on a quasi-monthly basis. You know, stuff. You know, so I just didn't have time to get to it. But
the trick is to
drop out. Said, the snails are done. They were handed to me last night. Oh, they are so beautiful.
Fresh from the lab.
They're just so beautiful. Like, I just keep petting Larry's eyebrows.
Damn eyebrows.
They're bushy and magnificent.
Are those modeling for advantage?
Yeah, those eyebrows are pretty on point.
They really are. But I went to Will's house not to pick him up, because we were going to go play MCP, because he and I are going to play MCP.
No, shut it down. So,
shut MCP? Wow. Tell me more.
God damn it.
We've talked about it before. I like trying to figure out their objectives, like why they're doing the things they do. Because when that comes towards us in Legion, we'll have some understanding of why that is and how they're designed and what they're thinking about. We had this conversation about X-Wing going to objective play. Yeah. And you can get a lot of their objective stuff. I mean, it looks a lot like Legion objective stuff, but also it feels a little bit like MCP objective stuff. So Will and I'm playing out of Will's box. I don't actually own any MCP.
So hold on. Are you first trying to throw Will under the bus for why haven't you been playing? And now you're saying that you're doing, like, deep dive next meta objective research?
Yes, I am.
You're covering up for not actually playing the game that we're here to talk about?
Remember, right. I'm getting a doctorate in theoretical studies.
So yeah, this is exactly how we do the these hustle. Things. He's playing 4D chess over there.
Theoretically, that degree is better.
Their design space by playing the game they actually wanted to
have. It's the game they advertise on their website the most.
Yeah,
so.
It's their baby, and then they have the stepchildren, which is our Star Wars games.
I'm just trying to make mommy and daddy love me more.
That's generally what I feel like when I come in and I hear Ben addressing everybody else. He's like, all right, cats, get in line. It's time to start the podcast.
Here we go. Will embarrass the pants off me for like 4 rounds. Of the 6 you get to play to get to 18 points, it was just gross. Like, it was just
Ben was getting
saddening.
A bit tilted by all the damage coming in.
Good. Will was trying to be kind and not throw damage at some people. Like, no, Will, you know you have to. It has to be done. Go ahead and kill me. Murder me now. Yeah, it was gross. Hulkbuster's gross. But he throws all the things. Will's playing the Avengers. I was playing the Crime Syndicate. So, you know, Kingpin and, you know, Goblin and all that kind of cool stuff.
Oh, but how about that Shadowland Daredevil for Criminal Syndicate?
Oh, no! Not LJ, too! So, right.
It looks so nice. So, no, legit, I was just losing my pants off. Like, he knocked out three characters in a single round before they could do much of anything. And then I still somehow won, because that game is twisted and wild.
Yeah. Nebula did 5 damage to Hulkbuster. I don't know what's happening. So, anyway... Marvel Crisis Protocol, you know, I really enjoyed our game, Ben.
It was quite fun.
Yeah.
It was very cinematic.
It was always really cool. You know, I enjoy the terrain interaction in the game.
I did. I did get to throw the Black Widow. I tried to throw her at Deadpool, but there was a truck between us, and so she hit the Chimichanga truck first.
Which knocked her out. She went head first into the bumper.
Should have just thrown her off a cliff instead.
I did make Deadpool drop the Chimichanga, which I then picked up.
Yes.
And so
Are you just making up random terms for this
Doc
game?
Ock had 4 celestial hammers and a chimichanga. It was, I don't know what was happening.
It was. Yeah, Doc Ock did have a hammer and 4 legs and 4 of the spider legs. And then he also had a chimichanga in his human hand.
I don't.
Yes. So the chimichanga heals you. This. And then you got more dice.
Yes, yes.
But literally it came down to the final end. I think I won 18-16. Like it was, if Doc Ock had died when he probably should have. I think I lose that game. So.
But Will, what about the Legion you played?
This is still Ben's turn.
So anyhow, I have a list prepared for Adepticon. I am definitely playing next week. So I got plenty of Legion time left in me.
What's your affiliation? What, Ben? Before we move on, what's your affiliation to MCP?
I really like Spider-Foe/Criminal Syndicate. Like I'm a stand for MODOK. It makes no sense at all. I just love me some MODOK.
He loves Patton Oswalt MODOK.
It really, yeah.
That's understandable. He does a great MODOK.
I love Kingpin. I love the Goblin. Like, in fact, the team I've got prepared for Adepticon lets me balance between either one of those two factions.
Yeah, there's a lot of overlap there. I like I like Foes as well, but I splash in some Black Order.
Ooh. Okay, I can see that.
Yeah, I go murder. Full murder hobo.
Full murder, yeah.
Nebula's so good at murder hoboing, just... She'll die quick, but it's lots of fun when she gets there. It was just weird, dicey stuff. Like, it really was,
it
like, the Hulkbuster refused to die.
It's a spiky game. But as long as you know that, I mean, it's just fun and fun and shenanigans. It,
super cinematic. I mean, Crossbones went at Cap America. I had to get the kill, and I did. Goblin was like, I'm going to do a cool thing. No, not in fact at all. Dead. Black.
Yeah, Goblin got one shot by a Captain America shield throw, just donked him in the head, knocked out immediately.
Bonk. Mysterio took a tumble very early.
Yeah, Mysterio got one shot by a meteor hammer fist from the Hulkbuster.
So from space, just came down, kapow. I mean,
as he tends to do.
And then there was a laser beam from also space. Like it was gross. It was
punch,
it was a lot
move, blast, Helios laser, bang. It was a time.
It was a lot of fun. It really was a lot of fun.
Marvel's always a good time. And then we're playing in the silly Infinity War thing at Adepticon on Thursday, which will be even more weird shenanigans.
Also playing the Legion. Also playing the Dinova event on Saturday. So, you know, I have Legion in my future, guys. You know I'm never far from you guys. Never far from you guys.
You can be quite far, actually. What's the...
But he's on a podcast, so...
Yeah, well, that doesn't mean anything.
So clearly he knows what he's talking about. Yes,
right, yes, yes. He's researching, damn it.
Listen, I played 3 games 2 weeks ago. That's about average on par for me.
Quarterly couple games in.
Ben's tree beard being like, don't be too hasty.
There'll be games of Legion to be played.
We're going to put that on a name tag for you,
before
Ben.
He plays a game.
I played 3 games 2 weeks ago. That counts.
Wait.
There you go.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, no, that's about also tree 2 weeks ago.
Yes, yes.
Listen, I'm making some hats. It's a possibility.
This is where also talk about MCP, right?
Well, no, you've been playing the X-Wing. The X-Wing Knights have tried to come back in a more organized fashion with 2.5.
Yes. X-Wing is back on Thursday nights at Sci-Fi City. If anybody listening wants to try out the new objective format, it's really fun. We've been having a good, reliable crew showing up, like at least 4 and sometimes up to like 7, I think we had one Thursday night.
That's cool.
Yeah, and you know, the new format, you know, people are kind of hesitant, but since playing it, I really enjoy it. I think the new upgrade system is really cool. And yes, it lets you do a lot more stuff. And so you forget stuff a lot more. But it makes sense with the objectives that, you know, optimizing your killing power isn't always the best move, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah.
We talked about that in Legion in the very beginning.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of early Legion players were all about kill. And they're like, X-Wing, that's not how you win games. Yeah. Is that how you win games in this one? Is you got to do some objective work.
Yeah, and I don't know if we talked about Seneca playing X-Wing at Cherokee, but since I have trained him in the ways of objectives through Legion, he had a bit of an advantage over X-Wing players who were like, I don't know, I go kill you.
Yeah, I remember he came over and talked a couple times about like, yeah, I just did the objective and I just got all the points.
He had one game where he like five straighted past someone when they expected to have an engagement because he was like, I'm gonna go get this objective and win the game, and the guy went, oh shit.
Yeah, that is the story about how I won my first X-Wing game 22.
The players might be having a bit of a struggle adapting, but I think it's a better format and allows more interesting things.
You want to talk about some spicy people on the internet? Oh God, the X-Wing groups right now.
It's a thing.
It is. I mean, we joke about that in Legion. We're nowhere near that spicy.
Yeah, we're not that bad, yeah.
We're a hummus, if at all, at best in Legion, by comparison.
Was that a clever segue to Tim's next segment?
Yeah, I was waiting for that. I was waiting for, speaking of spicy people, Tim.
Right, yeah.
Well, Tim, you may have had some complaints about the way we represented your play at Cherokee.
Listen.
I say that is a you problem because you did not appear on the podcast.
Yeah,
to rectify that event now.
This is like the newscast that comes out after the initial newscast. Like, we would like to clarify our earlier reports and correct any mistakes that we've made. And they have like
just STABcast like redactions.
The running revision. List. Like just the huge like Star, ironically, the Star Wars style like list of just running and going and going and scrolling text. But anyway, yes. So number one, even though you both narrated that I played three games for day one and then somehow lost two, but then still ended up 2-1. So something in your logic didn't make sense. So no, dear listeners, it was incorrect.
Which is you lost emotionally.
I was 2-1. No, first two games were basically the same list twice, which was annoying. But it was funny. It was Maul Magnus. I won one versus Maul Magnus. I won my first one, not lost. But then my second game was Maul Magnus against the Unrecovered Supplies one, and that one I did lose. Yeah. And then my third game was Vader Dues with Hostage, and that was an entertaining game. That was also pretty solid win. It was good times. I had to educate someone on, unfortunately, your mortar cannot pick up the hostage. I'm sorry.
It's oof. True. No.
Yeah.
So you beat him as a new player. Got it.
It was one of the things that, like, you see it happening and you're like, I should say something, but surely he's not. I actually really did think, I was like, he's not going to do that. Like, he's got some other plan in here. He's going to do something else. And then I was like, oh, he's not. Oh, no.
Oh, no.
Oh, we have to have a conversation.
Oh, no.
Okay.
This is always one of my concerns when I see like a triple mortar, triple shorts list.
Yeah.
I'm like, you understand like three of those guys don't have thumbs.
Yeah.
You know. And that's a
their
that's
hands
a,
are full of all the criticals they'll roll.
Yeah, that's true. But it was good.
Or all the blanks.
It were good games. The second game we got done and with turn zero, and I saw it was recover with Maul, and I was like, on Lim Viz, I was like, well, congrats on the win.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, no. And Ryan, of course, came over and was like, Tim's being salty here today. And I was like, no, I'm just like, I was smiling when I said it. I was just like, yeah, I understand the writing on the wall. It's okay.
Smile through the pain. It's okay.
Yeah. Newsflash, he won. So he one-shotted both barks, basically. And it's like, okay, well, that was my hope. And now we're done.
Did he kiss you on the back of the neck first, or?
No. The first game, Maul wouldn't die. This is where Ryan said I was complaining about dice math. Yes, because it took me 25 hits on a mostly unsurged, undodged Maul to kill Maul. Maul just wouldn't go down. The final kill that finally got him was, I think it was a phase 2 or a phase 1 punching
him. Yeah, I was on the table next to you. You punched him into phase 2 in melee.
Yeah. Yes. All right, that's the one that does it. Okay.
This is the way.
Well, then I was hearing all these noises from your table there, and then I leaned over and was like, oh, how'd it go? And you're like, I won. I was like, well, damn.
So again,
all
you
that
can
complaining.
Have a valid you can have a valid complaint about dice math and still win the game. Those are not mutually exclusive.
I'm not saying you were wrong to do so. I just heard like all the complaining, and so I assumed the game was going a certain way. And
it came down. I won't give the whole report, but basically, long story short, the focus there was my Bark was able to keep his guys off his payload for a turn, and that was enough.
Spicy.
I canceled it out, so that one turn stalled it enough that I was able to get it. But yeah, so it was a good time. And then day two, I only was able to play two games, unfortunately, on day two. But still, so because I only played two on day two, I ended up 2-3. I didn't get a chance to go 3-3, unfortunately. But for day one, at least, quote unquote, the one that matters.
Yeah, you had a rough second day.
Well, now hold up. Before anything else happened on day two, I did say before we started this, I have to go. I can't make round three.
It wasn't like I just dropped.
Yeah, it was a scheduling issue.
You rage dropped. That's what we know.
A lot of people, but that's a lot of people on day two.
Right.
Yeah. As a guy who got to run that tournament, there are a lot of people like, listen, I get to play one game. Cool, not a problem. Come play.
Yeah.
Some of us just walked up and played a random game.
Yes, you did.
Well, it wasn't random. It was quite the opposite of random. You're like, you know what? I felt bad about yesterday.
Pre-planned game.
Seneca, who I can regularly destroy, who hasn't played in a long time. Come here.
He asked me, thank you.
Yes, he did. I saw it happen. So Yanni actually had some good legs. The biggest thing that hurt Yoda Anakin list was being 8-axe. It was definitely the hardest part.
Right.
But Naked Phase 2s are my new favorites. Like, they're awesome. They're a little expensive still, so it's a little rough to bring them. But, like, if I can fit a couple squads in there, yeah, they are solid. Because they can just hold the back line. They can do objectives, and they're pretty solid at doing that.
I guess just edit that.
Two courage, man. Two courage does a lot.
Two courage is great. Like, honestly, yeah, I mean, like, they really worked out.
Wouldn't it be really cool if we could get something that didn't run away or lose actions?
Hey, listen, I have stormtroopers too, all right? Listen.
I've always thought Shore should have had two courage. I don't know why.
For expensive as they are, but we won't go on that tangent. We're not going down that road.
Tim, I have
you know what? If I put on board shorts, I too would have two courage.
I mean, it takes a certain amount of confidence.
Now, Tim, I have a question for you.
Yes, sir.
I have been debating between the Naked Phase 2 or a Phase 1 with a fifth dude, which are both 62 points.
Oh, I would say Phase 2. I actually had that same debate. I went back and forth. But because of that courage, Phase 2. And also, don't forget, it's courage and a free surge token. So you basically, you're not always surging on defense, but you could surge on defense when it matters most, potentially. So,
that's true.
I'm a big fan.
Yeah. Or your buddy nearby could surge and you could save their life.
True. Yeah. Exactly. I think that surge is so useful, even with just a single token sharing. I think it's still helpful. And then courage
even
too.
Even single token. Single token sharing is still fine.
Yeah.
Like, it's...
Yeah, it's still good. Yeah.
Yeah. Especially if you have some exemplar bullshit.
Because I don't Republic, do they just get a surge token every round, right? They don't have to get an order, right?
Yeah. It's just automatic. Yeah. That's the nice thing.
Yeah. If they're the same cost, I think you're going to get more than, like, if you forget the courage for just a minute, you're going to get more than one wound out of the reliable. So I think if you're debating that particular choice, I think the phase two is the better option.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, the courage is just gravy.
Yeah. The courage lets you take objectives without fear, pretty much.
So, Tim, you are dabbling into your robot army. So you've actually played Ion Spiders now? Like, you've put them on the table?
Yes, I'm dabbling in some droids. I was waiting on some of them to get built. And
The workshop works at its own pace.
We pay you and then we beat you. You know, we slap you with one hand, pay you with the other. Yeah, you did great. You did. But yes, so I was able to play with a snail tank. It was fun. I played snail with double ion spiders and a magna. It sounds a little
Did you familiar. Use your magna guard that has one leg?
I think I did.
Why does he have a peg leg magna
guard? No, he doesn't. No, I didn't use the one leg. I used the one that's like dancing. The one that's like gracefully falling backwards on a leg.
The ones that you built, that one of them is doing a catwalk.
Yes, that's exactly. He looks like he's walking on the...
I need pictures of this, Tim. Yeah, I've not seen these.
I'll get you.
There's a squad of Magnas that Tim built on his own and have interesting results.
Unsupervised.
It was a rush job.
Unsupervised.
Yeah.
Then
it was
he
very much a rush job.
He built like 4 of 6 and then gave me the rest of the sprue and said, build the other two, please, along with his other stuff. And I messaged him.
I need those,
like,
other two to match.
Well, I said,
need
Tim,
you to take your artistic flair and make them match.
No. Well, so I said, Tim, I'm missing a leg for one of these. is it okay? And Tim's like, yeah, that's fine. So he has a guy who's balancing on one leg.
It's amazing.
If anybody's going to get away with it, it's going to be Magna Guard.
Yeah.
Exactly.
It's true.
I mean, that's a perfect one to do it with.
Yeah,
a one-legged Magna Guard is going to be better than a three-legged of anything.
Yeah, the cape is another point of contact because it's sweeping around to the side, so it worked out.
Oh, that's true. That's true. But yeah, it was fun. Actually, my opponent also had Ion Spiders, so I had a snail more than he
ion
had.
Fight. And
yeah, it was Ion on Ion action. Slightly won, but it was a good game. It was solid. He threw Cat out in the open a little bit. Ion Spiders are dumb, and I don't love them. Like I played them. I will use them. Like I will use the tools that the gods have given me. But like, I'm terrified to bring a vehicle that doesn't have a red save right now, because I was just like, I'm just gonna get out Ion and I'm gonna lose two actions. Like I don't think that whatever heavy you bring is gonna automatically die. I mean, it has impact, but still, the problem is they just lose their action, so they're effectively dead anyway. So if you lose both actions, it feels real bad. One action I can handle. I don't care about that. But losing both, it's not a
favorite. Yeah, the fact that there's like, I think the spiders are like neat and they feel cool, but they're just so spammable, and that's the part that gets that can get really oppressive.
It can be rough. I do like the critical spiders. I think those are fine.
I get you with the original intent. If you're only going to get to use it 2-3 times a game, like, it's not quite so bad. But I can recover on a card.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I can override, so I can recover, you know, my normal turn. Like, I'm using them 5 out of 6 rounds mostly.
Yeah. Right.
I get it. But again, I'll bring them because they're good. But like, I shake my head as I shoot you with them and ion.
I do think I want to go with the rotary spider next, just because I want to just throw all those,
I think it's good. It's not like it's bad. Yeah. I think it's good. I think you put engagement on it, though. So that way, if you lose an action, you're not screwed.
Yeah, absolutely.
But the rerolls.
I know. But the precise two. But speaking of droids, LJ, I heard hot off the presses that you beat the pants off of Ryan. You just
it's not really hot off the presses anymore.
Took him to downtown.
Yeah.
Took him down to party town. No, we did get our team lane game in this last week. Mm. It was a lovely game. I have been trying to play a game of Legion with Ryan for, I want to say, 3 years now.
Something like that. It's been a minute, and so we both begged our captains, like, just put us on the blind pick, Matt. Make sure we pair.
Yeah,
we don't care about the meta. We don't care about the matchup.
Because, like, the joke is, we played in, I want to say, Invader 1 and maybe Invader 2, and we've been to a weirdly specific number of events to have been placed on the tables next to each other, and never have played, but we've always been like, oh, hello,
right next to each other. Yeah, and always same table side, too. Like, we get the same table edge, it's a lovely time.
Yeah, we're like, how's your game going? Oh, good, how's your game going? So yeah, we definitely took the opportunity to actually get paired against each other this time, which was lovely. I did listen to the previous episode of STABcast where Ryan talked a little bit about his dislike of payload. And so that was my goal when Ryan gave me blue, was to engineer a situation where payload was an option.
So, hold on. I do want to point out, so you did the thing that we always talk about in our paranoid hushed voices of like, well, we can't share our game plan before the big event because this is going to happen. And everyone's like, no one's going to actually just like snipe you like that and like listen to the cast to get an edge on you.
100% did, yeah.
No, but LJ does. LJ.
Absolutely. The deep research. The deep research.
Yeah. No, I we had a kind of a weird battle card layout, and
there was potentially a
mistake on my end when I submitted my list, because I had Liv Viz in there with the Snail Tank AAT list. I have no idea why Liv Viz was in my battle deck.
I was happy to see it.
But yeah, it gave Ryan kind of, I think, the comfort to accept that he was going to be able to get all up on me with his speeders. And, it didn't quite work out that way.
Yeah, I took Liv Viz mainly because, kind of in the same vein as why LJ wanted payload, he was like, I never play Liv Viz. I was like, well, I can take this. And then it also lets me get Pistol Cassian out. Cassian has a turn or two to get a little bit more aggressive and get towards the middle of the map instead of having to just hang back and plink away. And on payload, my idea is having Cassian walk with, you know, move with the cart, speed 2, get an aim token, take a pot shot. And it kind of worked that way, but not quite. So we both got it, like, in good balance turn 0, we both got a card we wanted.
Yeah, I think it was Liv Viz, payload, and major, I want to say.
Major. Yeah, it was major.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So, yeah, no, I think we squared off in a way that I was like, you know, okay, I feel like I've got a good chance here, you know, mm-hmm. keep the payload moving and isolate kind of Ryan's weaker elements that are on the flanks, and maybe try to overload one side and sweep in and stop the cart. That was kind of what I did. And Ryan set up pretty balanced with your two speeders. You weren't quite overloaded on one side. So it was like our heavies were squaring off against each other. And, you know, we were set. Ryan, what was your early mistake that we talked about?
Yeah, so I split my speeders at the start, and my hope was to try to fudge that I wanted to dive on the heavies. And I knew my plan kind of all along was, and it didn't quite work out, but I wanted to not really engage the heavies unless I really had to, and I wanted to use my big six die pools to A, get the super tack off the board, because he didn't have a great option for a second commander. You had one BX sniper, but he was way off in no man's land. And then it's just a bunch of B1s. And speeders are decent at clearing out your B1s. And so I kind of forked them away from each other to where they could meet in the back of your major offensive deployment. We can reassess where we're at from there. And then I put my paths kind of infiltrated them in the way of your bomb cart. So you kind of at some point would have to commit to them, because paths loves squaring off against hordes of B1s. In the long edge of my major offensive, there was this weird rock formation where I could go either behind it or in front of it. And with some chicanery, the snail tank could get to one of those sides, but not both. I basically probably put R2 on the wrong side. But honestly, if I flip-flop where my Rebel Troopers and R2 are, I still think kind of the same thing happens. But my R2 was in a place where I knew his snail tank would be able to shoot me, but I thought he was going to have to double move to get there so he wouldn't have all the tokens, and R2 can maybe make it. I also put my two speeders in the wrong two spots. I should have switched where my hotshot and where Shriv was, so I could throw suppression on R2 early, and that was my big mistake.
How do you know the word chicanery, but you can't spell from correctly?
He's a true enigma, Tim.
I had to look that up. I'll give you credit there. I had to look it up. Like, you're just making up words now. Like, no, that's a real one.
You did.
Congrats. You did not. You got it. You did it.
So many homeschool kids in this chat.
It's very true.
Okay, so you set up, like you said, pretty balanced, but maybe you wanted to flip. Yeah, you realized R2 was in a bad spot, and the snail tank showed him the way.
It did. It did.
Sure
did.
Showed him the way to. Showed him the way back to your sideboard.
Yeah, pretty immediately.
Did you get to double ion R2 at least?
No, I didn't need to. He just died.
Oh, just died.
Because see, okay. The way that I'm playing my snail tank is I've always been playing it as a pure gunboat. So yeah, he takes hypervelocity shells and the main gun, and I mean at range four, you're throwing eight dice.
Yeah.
You've usually got an aim from link targeting array, and I think in this case I may have even thrown him an extra aim from Kalani.
You had the double aim. Yeah.
Yeah. So he basically threw either seven or the full eight hits, I believe. And I mean,
yeah, you got all
know, you can only save out of that so many times.
This,
you know?
I wasn't
that time.
I only rolled four blanks, to be fair. Like, it was close.
Oh, and I think that was the comment, was like, I saw all of the successes before I saw any of the blanks because of the way the dice fell. And yeah, I was like, well, I guess I'm conceding turn one. Because if it's going to be this guy, I'm going to go back to bed.
My school of thought. Excellent. Yes, exactly.
Yeah, I was like, man, the big play failed, and here we go. But yeah. No, it did fall my way in that case, and that definitely kind of kicked things off, I think, in a very positive way for myself. But, you know, you made it a game.
Yeah, and it, like, your snail was out there, and due to the way some of the terrain on that map was, like, you did have to maneuver around some stuff. So my Rebel Troopers got into some side arcs. My speeders, I thought, had a pretty good approach vector, and my speeders for the first two turns were rolling. Like, with their aim tokens, I was getting, you know, six hits every cool shot, which felt pretty good.
Yeah, it did not feel very good to Kalani.
There were some things in that game that, like, my lack of experience with snails, because Ben never shows up to play,
I just got them last night, like less than 12 hours
neither
ago.
Neither one of you playing. Get out.
And you should have showed up to play.
Yeah. I'm gonna blame you. You get to blame Will. Will, you can blame Tim, and the cycle will continue.
I don't blame anybody. I'm a nice person.
I blame the dice.
And so the one call I kind of wanted to make was I didn't want to engage the heavies because they don't attrition. Like, they are just as effective at six wounds as they are at zero. I dove both of my speeders, I don't think I got their turn one, but turn two onto Kalani. Was that the right call?
I think so. Kalani, like you've already pointed out, is such a huge courage linchpin in the list. With you rocking K2's or Jin's gun on K2,
mm-hmm.
eliminating a commander and going for a panic is a viable tactic, especially in payload when you need to keep moving forward. And of course, you know, he enables me with several different fancy command cards, and so I think you diving in on them was the right move, even if it did eventually spell doom for one of those speeders.
Yeah, I dove both of them in, and I had a... It wasn't a great shot, but I did have a shot with Cassian if I needed it. I was making sure I kind of had that lined up where I saw like a corner of a silhouette if I needed to recover Cassian, get into sniper mode, and put a last damage there. But luckily, my two speeders took care of the robot.
I think the other good thing about the dive, too, is that you bypassed the main firepower of the AAT because one of your moves with your right, my left hand speeder,
mm-hmm.
put you in that range one bubble of the AAT, and then you flew over it and passed it. So that was the other thing, too, was with the way that my heavies were arranged, I could not focus fire with my heavies on your heavies, and that led to me just 100% focusing on your troopers for the entirety of the game.
And then when we kind of come into turn three, Kalani's dead, R2's dead. Both of those activations are pretty important. I'm bleeding troopers left, right, and center, but I want to start focusing on this snail tank. I think I got both my speeders like into side arcs, and it just saved like a champ. I want to say it saved 4 for 6 out of one of the shots. It was mind-boggling.
Yeah, the between the dodges on Kalani and preservation protocols, because the turn Kalani went down, I was able to get that card out. Mm-hmm. So I was dodged up for a majority of the time it was taking fire, and its saves were on point. That definitely kept me in that early game.
What programming did you have on the snail?
I used the attack protocols.
Okay.
Yeah. Especially with the way that I use it as a range 4 gunboat, I don't really need the engagement or the movement protocols.
That's fair. That's the nimble outmaneuver is really nice, but I think attack is probably the better call there. But mm-hmm. yeah, nimble defense can also keep you alive.
For sure.
At that point, we had both kind of like cemented our plays. My speeders were one of my speeders was pretty wounded. The other goofy thing I had going in this list is I had R2, I had K2, I had double speeders. And then I also had two R4 astromechs in my rebel troopers. Like, I had like repair 8 or 12 in my army. It was an insane amount of repair, and LJ kept me from using any of it by nuking R2 and then going after my core. And they weren't quite at the range where I was trying to get my core to intercept my speeders, kind of as they had to turn around. I was bleeding core way faster than I could deal with them.
Yeah, it was like the first turn I nuked R2, the second turn the snail started the turn and nuked a full mm-hmm. rebel repair squad. And then those commandos actually swung super wide, and they were able to, I don't know if it was quite a last first, but essentially they finished half a rebel squad and then shot it again and finished it. So yeah, I don't think you got to use any of your repair that game.
No, I didn't. And that was pretty, pretty key, because my goal was to try to keep those speeders up as long as humanly possible. Due to my lack of experience with payload, once I did get the snail kind of out of the way, to get it out of the way, I kind of had to block myself my own payload cart up with the base of my T-47. That kept me from getting it in base-to-base contact with my objective. LJ was still way ahead on kill points anyway, so he was going to win regardless. But it was still good experience, you know, for an objective. And like, there was a bunch of stuff in your list that I haven't played against or played versus in a long time, and so like, I really actually valued that game quite a bit, even though I lost.
You helped me overcome some payload demons, because mm-hmm. the story of my YBTL this season is remembering how to play Payload correctly. I played way too many games of Payload this season, and it was nice to cement a strategy in my mind and see it through to the end. And you know, there was some other stuff that, like you said, went my way with the good defense saves, and also, you know, just getting picks early. And you know, that's something that I hope people continue to experiment and try that Snail tank, because you know, it is taller than people think, and it does bring a lot to the table.
Yeah, now we did both agree we're gonna put a big old asterisk next to the game, though.
Oh Lord.
Oh yeah, I cheated immensely.
Yeah. What? LJ just straight up cheated.
What I learned in that game is that I'm extraordinarily bad at clock keeping on TTS. It's just not natural for me to go up and press the button, whereas like in person I find clocks to be much easier to use.
Yeah, that's right.
And then there was a dodge token where like Ryan shot me with the harpoon gun.
Yeah.
I rolled the die and was like, wait, I have a dodge, and I failed the save, and Ryan so kindly let me spend the dodge.
It was a gentleman's
and,
game.
You know, he's like, oh, now that you've seen the result, you want to spend the dodge, huh? So I appreciated that. I mean, I can't say we played fast and loose, but you know, we were pretty forgiving to each other.
Yeah, we were there to have a good time.
You always appreciate going into a match with that kind of mindset as well.
LJ, who won the series? Who won the series? I lost the game, but who won the series?
I'm pretty sure the people won the series, Ryan. and by the people, I mean the Bush Pigs, who are the final as we speak.
Oh, gross.
It's true. Yep.
I am bummed that we were not able to win that series, because the other team that was in our pod was the team that's currently in the final. So it would have been kind of fun to have like a reunion. Our battle would be legendary. But, you know, the series went to 3-2. And, you know,
yeah, it did. It was a close series.
And we finally got our game in. So you can't ask for much more than
that. It's true. No, for sure.
Well, all this talk of practice and shedding off these bad habits and things we're worried about sounds like we should just be playing more Legion. So where should we be playing more Legion?
Well, funny you should ask. Invader League is back, baby. And I don't have to run it anymore.
Nice. Yes,
I did transition this season to the team that is currently running it, which is an awesome, awesome feeling to be able to give your baby off and have it thrive. The team, you know, under Mike, with Nima and Droids returning and Madman helping do the advertising, Keegan on the streaming, and Alderaan is always running the website. It's so cool to see them go and grow and continue to deliver success.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For me, now that Team League is over, I would like to play in a couple in-person events later this year. I'm hoping to do Legion by the Bay, maybe Lone Star Open, SoCal Open again.
That's and a weird so way for to me, say Rocky Top.
Well, I mean, that's like the poor man's
It's a
Rocky
little
Top.
It's a little closer, sorry.
But farther from our hearts, and that's what counts. So that's
you're right,
the real distance
right.
measure.
Well, you know, what I need and what I have is a Stabcast fanny pack.
Yeah, you already got that. So.
That way I can still rep on this coast. And really, it's the ever pervasive effect of Ryan's influence everywhere.
Oh, God.
And
oh,
by
no.
extension, you, no. the Stabcast.
The number one rule of the Stabcast podcast is that we do not inflate his ego.
Why would you say that it's an extension of Ryan? Oh, no.
Because at the end of the day, I'm an agent of chaos.
I mean, damn it. You know, I thought we were going to make it to 100 episodes, but it looks like episode 93 is it.
That was
so, it's been fun. Wrap it up all up. That's bring down fine. The curtain.
Catch Ben and I on our MCP/Earth Strategy Battle Game podcast.
We've been, I look forward to the intro where Ben's like, we've been Legion free since episode 93, baby.
Yep.
But, this
Ben's
is
been Legion free much longer than that.
I played 3 weeks ago.
This is my opportunity to get some practice in.
Yeah,
this the list that I intend to run is actually the one that I've enjoyed most lately, which is also a Snail related list. And you know, for me, this is my time to get some reps in before these tournaments come up. So I'm really looking forward to it.
Nice.
Yeah, no, I'm excited. It should be fun.
So Ryan, are you doing Invader League this year?
Yes, I am. I'm playing. Ooh. They've changed the format up. Considerably, and it's a cool format to try to help localize things for a lot of players. And due to my goofy hours and my apparently now cultural affiliation. I'm playing in the Australia region.
I always managed to grab Australians in the Invader League. I don't know why that is. So I was always playing at 4 a.m.
Yep. Well, they've done a cool thing now where the group stage is very similar to how it's been. But now they're doing single elimination brackets per region. And then each region is then going to send, I think, 4 players into a grand final. And so there's 2 U.S. regions, an Australia, Asia-Pacific region, and then Europe. So,
nice. Yeah, that should make it a little easier on people's time clocks.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and
that's really nice.
And it gives you 2 opportunities to change your list. So you'll get to play 3 different lists in each stage of the bracket, if you so choose.
Tim, are you Invader Leaguing this year?
Sadly, I'm not. I can't have the attention or time to devote to it. I would end up just being that guy who's like, I can't get him to schedule. And I don't want to be that guy. So it's easier
But remember that time you played all your games in a week? That was fun.
That was a different time in my life. But yes, it was a very different time in my life.
No more Legion Iron Man.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And it worked out so well for me with all those losses.
You were like, I'm either going to make it or I'm not. So let's find out now.
And the answer was not. Not for that time.
But remember, it was just like the season before that where you were like 5-0. And then we're like, what happened here?
Yeah, exactly.
A bunch of people were sleeping on Tim. That's what's happening.
Hey, that was my Aiden Dubek double bike list or something like that I had. It was a good time.
I will say the Stabcast is sponsoring the Invader League this year.
Yes.
True, as always.
I did attempt to buy out the entire bottom tier like I did last year. I was told no. So we only have the last 4 spots because you know the Stabcast always supports the bottom of any tournament bracket.
Yep, absolutely.
That's, man, the fact that we can't buy out the whole bottom, that's like reverse corruption. I hate it. This is weird.
I get it. You want to share the wealth. There's lots of people who want to sponsor.
No, we're trying to be like the weird kind of like low level corruption, and you just won't let us. It's very rude. It's very hurtful.
Listen, hang on. That's not true, because LJ let me actually create a bottom tier last year. Like,
that's true.
We expanded 8 brackets last year.
You created a whole tier of prizes by wanting to sponsor the bottom. It was excellent.
Here at the Stabcast, we're trailblazers, really.
That's right. You can't bribe me with fanny packs anymore, because I'm not running it.
That's exactly it, so...
Damn it.
The new organizers have been fantastic to work with just on the sponsorship side.
Yeah.
I am now Mitro's favorite Stabcaster. So just heads up, guys.
I mean, he
said that
to
me. I have screenshots. So
I think he says that to all of us, but yes. Okay.
Listen, I sent him a Who Framed Roger Rabbit, Jessica Rabbit playing patty cake gif. He's like, you're not my favorite.
Of course. Yeah. Of course you did. Will, Ben, are you guys playing Invader League?
No.
I'm not. With the timing, too much classwork between now. This is weird. Like, I'm writing a lot or I'm not writing. And so I just don't have the time to dedicate to it.
Okay.
I wish I did, because I actually liked Invader League. I like the streaming. Like, I mean, I tend to watch the streams while I'm working on papers or doing the research. Yeah. Or I'm reading articles and annotations. Like, I'm watching the streams, but I just can't think I can play.
Yeah, I told Keegan if I can, I might try and pop in and help cast some. That's a little bit easier to pop in and out of, a little bit less, more non-committal. Right. So.
Or a couple seasons ago, just do what I did and just like join the bottom of the waitlist and like inherit someone's 3-game record, play 2 games, call it a day,
make the cut, and be accused of cheating.
They all need replacements, and you could start with a 0-2 record, and half your work is done.
Yeah,
that's true. That's true.
I'm going to ask the question, but I know the answer. Did you take any photos of this game online? Any screenshots?
No.
Things to share? Beautiful. See, I really like TTS. Like, I really like the mod. I love all the artwork in it. And it's so easy to take a screenshot. It's F12. It's F12.
All right. Well, hold on. Like, we could have commercialized this thing. We could have gone out and found a streamer. But at the end of the day, me and LJ just wanted to catch up and like, have a good time. We haven't played in 3 years. This doesn't have to be for you, Ben. This can just be for
us. But that's why you take the photos. Look, have fun memories to look back on.
That's why you have someone stream it anyway.
To change my chess clock. Why would you take screenshots? We had to play, like, Ryan had to play on my turn because I played on the entirety of, like, Ryan's turn one time. Yeah. it was bad, guys. It was bad.
But we're both fast players. Both clocks had, like, 25 plus minutes on them, so we were fine.
Well, yeah, when you don't hit the button, that's how it works.
One of our clocks was always running.
Yeah, it wasn't that I didn't hit the button. It was that just Ryan was activating on my activations, and I was activating on his at one point.
Yeah, it came out in the wash.
It's more a set of guidelines.
Well, it does turn out, if you put a camera in Ryan's hands, he will take photos. So I do have a photo album from Cherokee that was provided from Alpaz because Ryan was using Alpaz's camera. And so no. I'll post those photos up on the Instagram.
Not, where you all can see not them. Quite the case. That is Alpaz's camera that he handed me at New Orleans and just got us the photos for.
Listen, that's between you and Al. I'm just saying.
SD card readers are hard to find, okay?
It's true.
Oh, we should say, just shout out, because Alpaz tabled me day two at Cherokee. Like, yeah, straight up did. Just tabled me. So, yeah, good times. So, he's now got three of four of us.
Oh, no.
He just needs one more.
I'm the last and Infinity Stone. Help.
I told you that's why he's going to play us in Middle-Earth Battle Strategies game, so he can beat you there.
That doesn't count.
I need him to beat you, Will, but what he really needs to do, regardless of whether he gets you or not, is on his Stabcast fanny pack, he just needs to, like, bedazzle it with three gems and then, like, have a spot for a fourth gem. So it'll be, like, his fanny pack infinity. Infinity
I feel like
pass.
I'm about
there
to get visioned.
Yeah, he was.
He's going to kill me twice.
I got vision. God, he got me. Although I will say, Yoda was the last thing to die. Yoda lived the whole game and killed... Yoda also... I killed Jin and Cassian in, like, the same turn. It was a good time.
His,
oh, my God.
Attack. Day 2 list for Cherokee was gross.
It was, yeah. It was 12-act Rebels.
Ew.
Or 11. Yeah. Might have been 11.
It was gross. Yeah.
I mean, but what was grosser, it was unpainted. So
right. Yeah, that's why he didn't play it in the main event. Yeah.
Hard warning. There you go.
Well, his second hard warning, right? For no list and then Great Blast. Yeah, that's true.
Separate days.
Yeah, you know.
Well, if you want to see pictures up from Cherokee, from New Orleans, if you want to see some beautiful snails with some bushy eyebrows, I am posting those on the Instagram at SWStabcast. We can find all the great shots, all the pictures. While we're at Adepticon, we'll definitely be updating those live as much as we can. Now, Ryan will take no photos, guess what he does, but I'll definitely have my phone out and be taking as many photos as I can.
As will I. I love that Ben gets the Instagram plug, even though I'm the one that updates it most often.
Sure. I update tons of it, but you do occasionally update it.
Yeah, like I posted, be sure to harass us for stickers. We will have a ton at Adepticon. So.
Mm-hmm. Yes, they're very pretty. Listen,
speaking of shameless plugs, using your cat to push out
the people love Daisy.
Hold on. That was like the most engaged social media post I think maybe the channel's ever had.
I keep getting notifications.
I'm okay with it.
Yeah.
Yep, that and the snail.
Well, be sure to also check us out on Facebook, where stuff it gets cross-posted from Instagram, and the Twitter, where it doesn't. Mm-hmm. give us a rating on iTunes or a subscribe.
You
on
have
Spotify.
To press the button, Will. There's a button that links everything.
It doesn't
to
link it to Twitter. It links it to Facebook. You can't link to Twitter because they don't own the same.
They're different.
Cross-post is a legit
great
button.
Transition.
Would you like a screenshot of the button?
Go shove it up.
It says also
the button.
To Twitter.
If we've learned anything, it's that one extra button is too much.
Yeah, sure. I push a button and that's enough, okay?
So speaking of talking that shit, you can also find us on the Legion Discord and also on streaming services. Like I said, we've not been streaming in a long time, but I need to remember to do the host thing, because you can host someone else's cast. And I need to do that, and we should remember to do that for Invader League if we're not casting ourselves. So
I've got an auto host for most of the Legion content creators.
I need to set that up
out
mine.
There. We'll see if we can stream some games. I might be able to if work slows down, but that's probably not going to happen since I'm going to be playing.
My schedule might be changing.
Hours.
Yeah. So my schedule will be changing, I should say. So we'll see.
But yeah. You can find us on the Discord. I'm mostly these days hanging out in the Rocky Top open chat, and I don't know. You can summon everyone else with a tag, or you can engage with us by sending us an email at swstabcast@gmail.com like many fine listeners have been doing, and we're going to do a little mailbag catch up here in a little bit. Or if you want to support the show, as we just hit our 4-year anniversary. By the way, happy 4-year anniversary, guys. Yeah,
happy anniversary,
I'm so old.
This was like a special months. Occasion.
Yeah, it was.
Happy birthday.
And so you can check out and support the show by going to our Teespring shop, teespring.com/stores/stabcast, picking up some hoodies, alleged fanny packs, anything else that you might have. Every little bit helps keep the servers humming.
Listen, if you really like the X-Wing 2.5, you can definitely get some the Sun Sphere Defense Fleet merch over there as well.
I just posted that yesterday. All that up.
What's the MCP shirt?
Oh, we're working on a logo.
Working on that one. We're working on a logo.
All right.
I think Knoxville MCP has a logo, actually. We just
It does.
It's Galactus grabbing the sun sphere.
Well, that's pretty good.
I'll put that on a t-shirt.
That's good. That's actually pretty good. Yeah. Yeah, wait a minute. Okay, well then, right after that, get to work on the Middle Earth strategy battle game.
Oh, God. It's the sun sphere, but it's the Eye of Sauron. Okay.
Yeah.
This is fine.
I also own the Star Trek Attack Wars game.
Do we still have that Facebook group that's just us, Ben? Yes.
Why is the group called The Last Line of Defense? Just in case all other options fail.
At least we have one game where Ryan won't beat us.
I didn't beat y'all in X-Wing. Let's be real about one thing.
That's true.
Will
the news?
There it is. Do the thing.
There it is.
There's news, everyone.
There is actually news.
Battle Forces. It's a thing. It's kind of news.
Yeah,
someone wrote a lovely write-up of a stream, I assume.
Yes,
and I really do have to greatly appreciate the write-up there, because I don't have time to watch this during my workday, and then by the time I get home, I'll say like 2 weeks later, I can never find the stream again, because, you know, internets and stuff. And
Ben, is this where you talk about Atomic Mass's games?
AMG's website
posting.
Listen, Atomic Mass Games, you have a lot of job postings that you just publicly announce. Can we please get someone on that website? I know it's LFG, and I know Disney has to approve stuff. I do get it.
It's in the works.
But can we link some things? A text link. Like, let's go back to Web 1.0. Just give me a link.
Be patient, man. It's in the works.
It's been a year. Anyhow,
it's in the works. It's happening.
The write-up, thank goodness for the write-up here. But yeah, there's a lot of stuff.
Yeah,
I'm actually kind of surprised it's coming as early as they're hoping.
Yeah, so it's that they're intending to release in June. Has 22 miniatures in it. A bunch of... Oh, hello, Daisy Cat.
Yeah, we got Battle Forces. We are looking at June. I'm going to put an asterisk next to that just because...
Stuff.
Past histories, I think we're getting some things sorted out, so hopefully street dates and projections will become a little bit more reliable, but I'll believe it when I see it. Cautious optimism.
You'll see people painting it in June and be like, how did they get a hold of it? And then it'll be at your store in July.
Accurate.
Yeah,
it'll be
sounds
our
right.
local store in August. You know.
And then we'll roll some dice and see which continent doesn't get it till December.
My vote's for New Zealand. Just New Zealand.
I mean, it's usually Australia and New Zealand, but, you know, for Yoda Wookiees, it was us. And we'll happily take our turn on the ones being late. It's fine. But usually something doesn't get somewhere. Yeah, I know. It should be. That's why we're going to roll a die.
You're just going to rotate? Let Europe be the next one who doesn't get it for 3 months?
Yeah, that's fine.
Yes, I remember the great trials and tribulations of not having the Shadow Collective in Singapore. It was a dark time.
Where were you? Where were you when they didn't get their shipment?
Listen, Tim, you bought your Yoda from Britain.
No, that's not true. From Canada.
Canada's mostly Britain.
It's mostly Britain.
And I got my Wookiees. Ooh, that's true.
It's Wee Britain.
And I got my Wookiees from like Newfoundland and this little store. And you know how small the store is when the store goes, yeah, I got your order and I was sending it to you. How did you hear about me? I'm like, I have a web of connections for these things for just this moment. It's like, don't worry about it. I was like, but if you need more business, I'll send people your way. It's like, just might be a random Americans. Don't worry about it. It's fine. Will, what's some of the things that we've heard about this new Shadow Collective, other than the release date, supposedly?
The Shadow Collective itself is going to be a new faction, which is the Battle Force featuring Maul and all the mercenaries that otherwise would be spread around like jelly on toast.
Not a new faction.
Not a new faction.
I just want to point out that for them being, you know, the Shadow Collective, being delved in darkness and subterfuge, like, we do have quite a bit of information. Like, they're not doing a very good job at being shadowy. I just want to point that out from the get-go.
They were in shadow for a while. They were just that box art.
It was true. It was just the box
art. That's fair. All right.
So, like, the pikes, I mean, I love the fact that the pikes can be in all four, and I kind of like that iconography of having all four faction symbols in that upper left corner there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but they're relatively cheap for what they do.
Yeah.
48 points seems like a good deal.
Yeah.
Other than you just can't order them. I mean.
Right, but then they have bonuses for not being ordered, right?
I was going to say, they still get good things for that, so it's okay.
Yeah.
I like that they seem to capture that, like, you know, it the keyword is literally called independent in this case, but that independent nature, you know, where it's like, oh, we hired you to do this side gig while we're doing this thing, or we've hired you to die gloriously on this main objective while we do this side thing.
Exactly. Right.
I think, you know, I think when you think about it and you frame it in that mindset, people were like, I don't know, do the pikes really fit in all four factions? Yes. If you pay them enough money, the pikes can fit in all four factions.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's a lore, logistical, whatever you want to call it, way to figure out why they're there. So it's cool that, like, at a minimum, before we look at anything else, we know that all four factions are going to get to play with mercenaries. And that was something that I think people were worried about, was that, like, oh, I don't know, would, you know, Gar get to play with mercenaries? That doesn't make sense for them. And here we are.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, right. Yeah, they hire it out sometimes. Well, and it's nice, too, because, like you said, they're independent. And so, like, you don't have to worry too much about, well, how are they going to fit with everything else I'm doing? It's like, I mean, I'm sure there's going to be synergy and things we can explore. But, like, at the same time, it's almost on the side of, well, they don't have to. Like, they can just kind of do their own thing, and they can be effective at doing their own whatever. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I like that. I think that's neat. And there's so much more to see.
Yeah. I'm excited to see it.
This is just the tip of the iceberg.
Yes.
I'm excited to see some of the other battle forces as well.
Yeah. So one of the things kind of announced during the stream was the idea that, one, it'll be fluid what gets to be added in and out of it.
Right.
Like, they will change these battle forces so you can add, let's say Ahsoka appears.
Right.
Who knows? She might be appearing sometime, hopefully this year. But it's one of those, like, if she does, then they'll just change things. Oh, sure, let's add her to the 501st or whatever it is.
Right.
I like that it's fluid.
I am kind of liking the idea that they may release some print and plays until actual cards appear.
I really like that.
I mean, if it's just a unit list of stuff, like, why not just have it be printable, right?
Yeah.
You know? Especially for those battle forces that are units that we already have, and they're just more or less repurposed for some other kind of keywords or whatever.
For the four factions, what it sounds like is they're just variations on what you have already.
Right.
You use them in different ways, and so why not just have it be a rules doc, effectively, and then later on it can be a card or whatever else, however you want to do it that way.
Well, and that's the thing, like, almost all of us, I should say, are going to buy it when it comes out anyway. Like, it's still going to get it, but at least we can get a feel for it. Heck, it lets you try things that maybe you might not buy, but, you know, like, oh, well, now I am going to buy this. I wasn't going to, but now I tried this out and now I absolutely want to. So
smart. The neat thing about, I think, that we kind of glossed over with the Shadow Collective box too, it's something they did with Rune Wars that I actually really liked.
Oh God.
I wish we saw in Legion. No, and that's just when you want to buy into the game, you don't have to buy a starter kit. If you just want to play Shadow Collective, you can get everything you need, like about a starter box worth of points for Shadow Collective, but there's not going to be any of the cards and stuff you need for it.
Right.
You know, now that we've always had, but now it kind of gives more credence to the Barricade expansion, the Dice expansion, the movement tool and rulers stuff. You. So you can you don't have to go buy a core box. I'm hoping, I would love to see a pack come out that has the original battle cards in it. So you can get all that stuff. I think if you
really go looking around your community, you'll find people who bought multiple core sets
that and have those battle cards. You can find those
cards. I think I have five original battle cards this point.
I was going to say, how many extra sets, Ryan, do you have for running tournaments?
Not that many.
Really? I had at least one full set of, like, the core battle cards that somebody just left at, like, LVO 2020.
Oh, no.
And the only thing we're short for the other factions is I would love an expansion that comes with Luke and Vader command cards Grievous and Obi-Wan. Yeah. So if you didn't want to buy and split a core box, you have access to everything you need. If we can get away from the core, the starter set, the business model. Now, obviously, those are things that should be made for players to get into the game together with, which is cool. But if you don't want to do that, if you don't want to split a box and you just want to play one faction, I would love for there to be a way to get those cards. This is a good sign for that.
There was an Obi-Wan box you could get that had his command cards in it and just his model. That's true. But it,
it's $500.
Yeah, it's pretty pricey. Yeah. If anyone wants to donate one, by the way, I would sing your praises.
It's nice, too, because, like, with the core box problem is that you have all these extra things for those of us that have bought three or whatever of them. Like, I'm actually looking at my desk right now in front of my face, just unpainted range rulers just sitting here because I don't know where to put them because I just have extra bits that I was like, and I like being organized. So like
I cleaned out my car the other day and found a range ruler in the like trunk under the carpet. I was just like, where did this come from? How long has it been here?
It's ridiculous. Who I have knows? Like 4 speed 1s and like 3 speed 2s. Yeah, it's ridiculous. So yeah, it's.
I do love the idea that we're going to get a dark saber that I can equip to Maul and make him a commander.
Yes, yeah, I love that.
And if he doesn't have the darksaber, then he is an operative.
And then he gets new command cards, but can use the old ones as well.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
We're looking
at Maul getting the Luke Vader treatment. Yeah.
Yep.
Bounty Hunter's getting a little bit of a buff up with some other stuff coming out. I don't know if it's going to be in a Battle Force, but something's getting updated for them.
my fear, and that's not really a hard fear, but do I want Rebels to have access to Bounty?
I mean,
they already have Secret Mission.
Where are they going to get?
Yeah, that's the question.
Cad Bane ish, maybe.
He's pretty evil.
He's gonna be a general groaning.
He's pretty bad.
Listen, if the Mandalorian had been willing to pay the price, Cad Bane would have stepped over the line. I'm just saying he didn't offer the appropriate financial incentives.
We'll see if Rebels get access to Bounty Hunters or not. Honestly, we don't care if Bounty itself doesn't get an update. Like, we'll just take your mission this every day. The cool thing about Bounty Hunters that I think they add to the other factions are neat opportunistic command cards. Something Rebels aren't really short.
Okay, I thought you were about to say short, and I was like, Ryan, come on! Like we can't keep this narrative going.
Like, no,
I can definitely see Cad Bane working for. Working for the clones. I can see him working for the Grand Army of the Republic.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean,
maybe.
But yeah, I'm excited to see
kidnap what Boba does. Supreme Chancellor Palpatine. So I don't know about that.
But
it got better.
It could be like you fall in love with your captors type situation.
Exactly.
At this point,
Stockholm Syndrome.
Like, no, join us.
Who hasn't captured Chancellor Palpatine though? I mean,
this is also true.
There's like those 5 people who have had him captive.
Mace Windu.
It turns out that Palpatine was making that happen the entire time. He'd arranged all of it.
Palpatine's behind it all.
All I need for the bounty update for Rebels, just to make Tim go full tilt and like maybe go play MCP, I need Han to get bounty.
Tim has played it.
Yeah,
he has had
it for a while.
It's true.
Yeah, if Han gets bounty, we have to give him weak point lightsaber.
Yeah, that's fair. Well, he's already got that, so it's fine. Yeah.
I'll give him that. Like, I'll take that. Like, if I can hit Han with a saber, then yeah, that's great. I just can't ever get there to do it. But yeah, it's fine.
But yeah, Bounty needs a much needed rework. Hopefully, it'll send some cool stuff out there and set a precedent for maybe more hunters to come.
And I want to see Boba. I just want to see updated Boba because like Boba.
Yeah, yeah.
He's
yes.
Every time I put him in a list, and I'm like, I could, or I could just bring I don't know. Pretty much anything else and be more effective. Like, yeah, I get it. He's a good box grabber. Squad. Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
I know he's a good objective grabber. I understand that. I don't argue that. But I don't know if it's worth paying all those points.
Boba for the same amount of dice as a Mark II.
Yeah.
I think if Bounty gets an update and Boba gets new command cards, I think he's okay. I think his unit profile is probably in a good spot. But his command cards have not kept pace with what some other cards can do. And I think that can be said for a lot of the wave.
Depending on what's on his cards, I wouldn't mind him getting maybe like 1 extra health. But yeah,
sure.
Just to keep up because it's just those dice pools are a bit rough right now.
Yeah.
And I would change those range bands so that they're not as a pain in the ass on his weapons.
It's rough.
Or at least knock him up to 3 black. I don't know. It's just
what are you going to give him? Raise 3 knee rockets?
Yes. Yes. That's got to be a command card. I got to have the command card knee rockets. So then you play jetpack rocket turn 1 and then knee rockets turn 2. There you go.
And then wrist rockets turn.
ever since a book of
it was even in Mando.
Ever since that his middle attack, that's what I imagine it is now. It's just his little knee rockets.
Yep.
Well, no, you know what they should do? They should change the range band. It should be melee-ed to.
Ooh.
There you go.
Ooh. There you that go. Way you could shoot him up close. I like there that.
Yeah.
So I'm also been of the opinion that we just give Boba the Anakin treatment and we just put permanent on all of his cards.
He puts
his armor on.
You know,
as he powers.
I've definitely thought about it, but I think like it maybe would be more more balancing if you took advantage of the expend or some of the other like sure. capacity yeah. type yes. things
yeah.
just to give
yeah.
it
yeah
a,
you could
give it
you
an
could
upper
move
floor,
a lot of that
but...
to an upgrade slot yeah absolutely
yeah
but true. I think not... like that's always a cool direction like that people have talked about going with the Mandalorian type stuff is yeah give them the options, give them the loadouts, give them the flexibility
mm-hmm. yeah
and make them kind of that you know multi-tool that people like to see them as.
The thing I'm surprised Ryan hasn't mentioned here is that the RRG is going to get updated when the Mercenaries and Battle Forces come out.
Mm, delicious. I love it.
I mean,
I like frequent updates.
We see it.
no, I like frequent updates. Negative Nancy over there.
So, yeah. No, I'll just see it when I see it. Once again, I'm not sold on timelines yet, but I will say, and I think LJ can also speak to this, the updates are a cool and awesome thing, but when you have to put on Judge Hat... The RRG does a really good job of telling you what the new stuff is. It does not always do a very good job of telling you what leaves. And so having to square rules versions in your head to make judge calls and stuff, and you're like, I'm pretty sure this is a rule, but maybe they took it out. I don't know. keeping track of like what's in which revision is can get tricky.
I have had similar with X-Wing lately where it's like, I know what the game was 3 years ago, but there's been so many versions that stuff that's new to me isn't blue anymore. It's been around so long.
Right.
It's like, I don't know. I
that
guess Tractor Beam works
time.
That way. Yeah. Sure.
Yeah.
So I understand the searching through a PDF like, wait, what did they get rid of? What have they done?
Now, I do want to say, too, it should be noted while we're still kind of semi on like new stuff and mercenaries and things like that. So with the new stuff coming out, with the new mercs.
Speaking of mercs, let me tell you what Deadpool did to me last night.
it's
merc with a mouth.
The fact that they do not count towards your minimum. That's important. So like, because I can definitely see the clone players, myself included, of being like, oh, I'll just bring I'll bring 348 guys instead of my 55,000 guys. That phase ones cost because phase ones are astronomical, but like you're just like okay, yeah,
phase
do
ones
that.
Are
no,
perfectly
they
priced.
They're not perfectly priced in any universe, but like they,
Tim, I will fight you.
That's you can fight me and be wrong. The South fought; they still lost. But like it's like yeah, it's,
wow, you
no, it's, it's yeah.
Stick that
I am glad that they won't count because it would have been a little bit too easy to spam them. But it's just as important.
It would have opened up things to. You know,
yeah,
which at least is, as I'm sure this will shake the meta up quite a bit, but that's why I don't, from what we've been previewed, don't see the Rebels taking a ton of this stuff because I think that's most of what we've seen has been cores and cores for Rebels, probably more than any other faction right now. Gar is probably pretty close, are just attacks
at the very least. It gives you a nifty a mobilize option,
yeah, it does.
That's true. You can take the whip pikes now that we know they fit in all four,
yeah.
This is true.
So at Sabine. The very least, Sabine. It'll give you a good whip option. Not to rag on my friend droids too hard, but you know, well, I think the Sabine's... pikes might actually see the table.
Hey, there was a game I played against David Endless, and his Sabine whip won the game because it stopped
whips. The whips always win games. Yeah. Boba, Sabine's whip, and even Magna whips to an extent. Whips are.
He stopped me from touching the point.
Make it the quote of the cast, but whips are great, guys.
But mercs and whips excite me.
Let me ask you, LJ. You're our rules guru. You know, you manage the forums, and so I imagine the RRG, they ask for your help. So when they come out with a new RRG, what's that workflow look like? I know you can't tell me what may or may not be in the thing, but how do you impact the RRG cycle?
So, you know, and Ryan kind of touched upon this earlier, and I almost said something, but, you know, he talks about getting confused between rule set A and rule set B.
Yeah.
Now add rule set C, D, and E, and you'll understand why I make the occasional mistake in public spaces when I hand out rules on, like, the Legion Discord and whatnot. You know, I'm kind of in, like, a unique middle ground where it's like, hey... Here, developers, you know, the ones who are doing the work, here are things and trends and, you know, rules that I've collected over the last year. Use this to inform, you know, if you want, use this to inform what you guys are working on. And so I think it's it's nice and it's a useful position to be in because, like, you know, not only with the RRG change thread, which is like, that's the gimme, right? That's the, hey, change these things. This is what needs to be addressed. You also are kind of in a unique spot to be like, hey, you know, I get asked this frequently asked question, like a lot. Is it something that instead of throwing in the FAQ section, can we, you know, amend a rule? And so that's kind of one of the unique opportunities that I'm afforded is, you know, I can collect and push that data to the devs for them to make decisions. And, you know, they had mentioned it on a cast or on one of their streams, so I'm not necessarily spoiling it here, but they have told us that they are working on a new RRG. So, yes, you know, that update that we should see around the time of Shadow Collective, that's not an RRG update. You know, in theory, right, that should hopefully be a new rule book, which will be super cool because I know people are a fan of their MCP rulebook, for example. Well,
and I just like the fact that they're able and willing, at least, if nothing else, that they're at least willing to look at the adjustments that we make and that up to this point we've had to wait like every year for, a whole year for, and that they're willing to do a little bit more frequent kind of updates. They said it's not guaranteed. Yeah. I understand that. But at least they're willing to have that conversation, which is good.
That's another like kind of peek behind the curtain type thing is, you know, people complain about the RRG being separated into three parts, but that's part of the reason why that was a good thing. Because it's like if we have to adjust points, now you have to send a 5-page document that doesn't have any imagery on it, which can go through Lucasfilm licensing a lot quicker than... you know, a 80, 90 page RRG that has pictures. Visual media is the thing that seems to take the longest, at least from my understanding.
Working in those secret Star Wars images and all of our card art.
I mean, like part of me is like, and is just like, pull all the art from the RRG for that purpose.
So there is part of me that says that, send me a text because file, fine.
The actual RRG, like Learn to Playbook, the stuff that comes in like players' hands, absolutely include all that stuff. But like the RRG, how many people are actively like cracking that bad boy open?
Well,
not a ton. Mm-hmm. Usually it's, you know, at game night, if you have a rules question, you're not going to crack the RRG open. You're going to go to the forum, go to the Discord, message me. I got a rules question at 4 o'clock in the morning from Australia this morning. You're probably gonna go somewhere else for it.
Yeah, I'm hoping that's something that the new one addresses is maybe it flows a little better to where people are more comfortable cracking it open to get those answers.
Okay, that's fair. Yeah,
I mean,
that's
just searched the PDF. It's fine.
Yeah, I searched the PDF myself.
Yeah, like, I control F, very everyone. Often,
control
actually.
F, is your friend.
Yeah. No, that's a tip for all you TOs out there, because I know Ryan already knows this, but whenever I throw together an event on TTO, don't forget, folks, you can add links to the top of your TTO event, such as your event packet or the rules forum or the RRG or even that nifty Legion quick guide.
True. From an undisclosed place that we're not going to, you know, propagate.
We don't talk about them. That is the dark, shadowy land.
So, yeah, that's, you know, that's something that I encourage people to do is, hey, give the players those resources, and they will crack them open and save you some rules calls.
Before we kind of wrap up the news, does anybody have any hot take on our pre-existing faction battle forces? I think we've kind of talked about them a little bit on the show before. I don't know in that regard if there's any new info.
I don't know that we necessarily had a name for it. I mean, we were pretty sure it's going to be the 501st, and pretty sure it's going to be the Trade Invasion Force. But...
Right.
Okay.
Starter box will not be 800 points for mercenaries. So that's good to know.
Yeah.
So that's, you can't wield a full army. So just putting that. Yeah, I think we'll be able to talk more about them, obviously, once they actually come out and we actually have
full cards. For now, it's just, I'm excited to see what they do.
Yes. You know, it's a good direction.
They add. You know, if it's like an all clone thing, that'd be pretty fun. Of just like, no Jedi, just clones and vehicles and fun.
Well,
I know they
said. Well, if it's 501st, there's one Jedi.
I don't know. Man. It could just be a Rex episode, you know.
Well, but they did say 501st will have this interesting like thing of where you can't bring like an arc strike unless you bring an arc as well. So it's just like a weird combo thing. Yeah, it's
give me arc buffs, please.
All right,
it's interesting of how they restructure
as a player basically. Looks super cool.
Yeah,
but depending on the level of stipulations as a TO with list verification the night before a tournament, this sounds like a nightmare.
Well, just increase your cap by a day. Give yourself another day. There you go.
Yeah. Boom. So, done. Or just maybe Tabletop Admiral will include the justification thing at the bottom saying, this is what it changed the rules to be, so you can check it now.
There you go.
Yeah, we'll see.
You know, we used to have to verify list day of when you're registered, but I mean...
Right. Yeah, back in my day...
That's easy for a 12-man event, but for a... when we're dealing with larger quantities, it's...
Then just do it a day
problematic.
Before.
Problematic.
You sign up for it.
Yeah.
I did. Speaking of events...
Whoa.
And headaches...
Whoa. Ooh.
So that's segue.
Whoa.
That's good. It was
we've
smooth.
We've got Adepticon.
So smooth, Adepticon I fell over out. On it.
That's right.
I was so hoping we were going to get painted models from the Shadow Collective at Adepticon. Like, Adepticon has always done previews of models. Mm-hmm. Like, we used to, very beginning of this podcast, like, we went to go take photos of the cool things, and that's when we found out Han Solo was coming.
Yep.
I mean, those
Red
kind of
save,
pieces.
So I was kind of hoping Han we were going to catch
yep.
So.
Listen, don't tempt
Lord
me anymore.
Lord preserve us.
But, you know, Adepticon, we are going to get to play with the Dianoga box on that Saturday.
Yep. Yeah.
So that'll be fun. I mean, there's, it's always fun to have the community there.
Are we all signed up for that, or did,
well,
did Ryan not do it?
I think... I have a ticket, but I've also been tapped to possibly stream and then possibly judge. So I will probably not be playing Dianoga Madness.
Well.
Even if if I'm not in the main event on Saturday, we'll see. I'll be around doing something.
I sadly will not be at Adepticon. I had to back out.
Yeah,
I had
to cancel.
I've had numerous financial things come up that we're all just like, hey, life happens.
From this.
Yeah, like, oh, life happens. Like, I'll recover from it, but not in time for Adepticon. Like, okay, hey, that tree's going to come down.
Yeah,
that tree's going to come down. Your tires are going to go out. Like, okay. All right.
And see, you'd already pulled out of Adepticon before the tree.
It's true.
And then the tree landed on your house.
Yes, I was like, I've made the right choice. Good for me.
No, don't try to sugarcoat it. You saw all the details for the Shadow Collective, and you
it's
were like,
true.
Oh, I gotta put aside money now. Sorry,
you say,
well,
you
I wouldn't have
too.
Cut Tim's tree down if he wouldn't have canceled on Adepticon.
There you go. it's a vicious cycle.
I thought I saw Franz running around with a chainsaw out there. That's crazy. In the middle of the storm. Man dressed up in a 501st outfit gutting down my tree. That's weird. But I will say, too, we should, for the news, before we move too far on, because it kind of ties in a little bit of Adepticon, because it's post-Adepticon, way post, but at the end of June, we're going to have another mini-stravaganza. We didn't have that in the notes.
Yeah, oh, that's right.
Yeah, I didn't want to touch that. End of June, almost July, really, we're going to have another mini-stravaganza. So there you go. So you might
hopefully
you'll see some stuff at Adepticon,
but
you'll see some stuff there. Yeah, exactly. So there.
But before we get there, we've got Adepticon next weekend. You're probably listening to this, hopefully on your way to Adepticon.
Ah, drive safe.
So
LJ,
April,
no Adepticon for you?
No Adepticon for myself as well. I have a, I have a 3-week training exercise starting on the 25th. So that took Adepticon right out of the running for myself. Yeah. I was super bummed because when I went in, what was that, 2019. I mean, that was like going to Mecca. You know, I had always wanted to go to an Adepticon and immediately signed up for the next one I could. And unfortunately, that was the first one, you know, the first big event that was canceled in 2020. Although I did get the swag box for that. The VIG package that year was most excellent and totally had some MCP in it that I totally didn't regret later selling because I may or may not have already rebought Venom. But it's okay. I'm not bitter. I very, very much wanted to go, probably not even to play. I think I probably would have also taken the support route and helped out Brendan or the stream or, you know, just really anybody that needed it. Or, you know, maybe I would have brought another game like strategy battle game or MCP or X-Wing or, you know, try to, you know, because I've never done that whenever I've gone to a convention, you know, whether it be Warfare Weekend or SoCal Open or Adepticon and all this, I have always played one game and I've only really traveled for Legion. So, you know, one of these days I would like to find an event that spans multiple game systems and bring multiple game systems and jump around. think that's a cool experience, and I've never done that. It is.
So a lot of last time I got to go to Adepticon was 2018. And so, like, I brought Imperial Assault with me. I borrowed some of the World of Tanks game, I think, and I played with Will.
Yep.
We played a little bit of Guild Ball, played some X-Wing and some Legion. Like, yeah, I brought a whole bunch of stuff.
Yeah, the FLG Opens usually only have space where you can play one, like, because you have a Friday, Saturday or something, you know, something like that. Mm-hmm. But Adepticon's great because you can do that, like, spread it around. Like, you know, we're going to play Marvel and Legion and maybe X-Wing. We haven't really figured that out yet. I mean, but, you know, just that it has that option is fun.
Just be able to pick up a pod of X-Wing and play. Or, you know.
I like that that's an option. And hoping that, you know, in follow-on years that Adepticon will be an option, because that is one that I will always try to make it to if it's an option.
It's probably my second favorite convention of the year. So
It's for the breakfast and the Portillo's, let's just be honest.
Yeah.
I am so sad about Portillo's. I do want some Portillo's.
That's the reason why I threw that elbow. Yeah. Like, Tim's going to be sad.
I'll tell you what, though. I'm going to Orlando in June. I'm going to get some Portillo's there because they opened up a random one in the middle of Orlando.
There you go. That works.
Right next to the
Chicago
hotel.
Native went down to Orlando. Was like, you know what we need around here? A Portillo's.
There's a White Castle and a Portillo's next to each other. I'm like, this That's clearly so Orlando is the promised land for me. Tortoise traps and White Castle and Portillo's.
No.
Hooray. I am trash.
Hey, Tim's from New York.
You are trash.
Now that he's old, he's going to move to Florida. That's how it works.
That's true.
So, Dallas Open. Who's going to Dallas? Anybody?
Roll call.
I don't think I can swing it. I'm gonna really try, but plane tickets right now are so expensive.
God, yeah, that's don't remind me.
Dallas is just that. It's just like 5 hours outside that drive window.
Yeah,
like 9 hours is a big deal, but it's that 14. It's that 15 hours. It's just a little too far.
Sadly not.
Good friend of the show, Zachary the Dwarf, is stepped up to run the thing, so I really want to go support him.
We just keep
him.
Changing his name every time we say it. Like, it's always Zach of some sort, but like Zachary, Florf the Dwarf.
No,
Zach
I got yelled at for referring to him as Florf in a real context, so
I would love to go help Zach out
month,
on that.
So.
Like, I would love to go stream that thing. I'd love to go play with Zach as a head TO, but I just can't make it in the time window.
Yeah, so I'm gonna see, depending on how much I have to work, the week I get back from Adepticon, if I don't end up having to burn all my vacation days, I may cash in some favors and try to get down there. But after that, we've got Atlantic City, which I've got a title to defend, and I probably won't. you're going, Tim. Yes. I'm going.
I don't know how I'm getting there.
You guys can make. I'm taking my car.
That's 11 hours, man.
Like, I know, it's like 13 because of traffic.
Oh, that's true. That's true. That's
but true. There's... I looked at it last year, and I looked at it even more so this year. And because of where we are, it's going to be quicker because to get layovers, and then you got to take a train from like either Newark or Philly.
Yeah,
like it's going to be tricky to get there. And by the time I looked at layovers, like I could do an 18-hour plane ride with a train, or I could just get in my car, go, and take a table of terrain.
A
car at the venue is nice.
It's
expensive. You can always drive to DC and then take the train from DC up. I mean,
you can take the train from 8 hours too. Yeah,
that's true. The Atlanta hours are always weirder, but
that's true. That's
very true. Atlantic City's gonna be cool. They're doing 264 man heats and then a top cut Sunday. So I'll be playing one heat and judging the other.
God, I'm so grateful for anyone who's listening. Any TOs, please do more Saturday heat things, because it makes it so much easier to make with work and things like that. Like
it's why LSO worked so well for me last time. I could leave work Friday afternoon, catch a plane, get there, and then play Saturday
because
and Sunday,
there's a direct from
Sunday
Knoxville
night.
To Dallas because reasons.
It's great.
Yeah
That's how that works. But
so two of us, maybe more, will be at Atlantic City. Was a really fun event. Nick's got some of the best tables in the biz.
That's true.
And then after that, we've this is out of order. Before that, we've got Rocket Top Game Con. slash Legion by the Bay, if like you're into that kind of thing, I guess.
Who would do that? Whoever
as
would
previously discussed, I may be into that kind of thing.
do you get to see humpback whales from the play space? Because otherwise, why would you attend?
Or elephant seals, maybe?
I don't know.
Oh, the elephant seals are just at the bottom tables.
I don't know if our room in 2019 had a great view, but you know, we're probably in a slightly different place than the last time. No, honestly, the that.
So it's Legion in proximity to the bay.
Legion in proximity to the bay. Yes. It's Legion by the Bay at KublaCon, yes, and it's okay. The Bay Area open for all the 40K and yes. Games Workshop
hey,
and
stuff. Yes, gotcha. Yes.
It is a lovely place to host a tournament, and I thought of this when I was, you know, when we were talking about it, or when I was talking about tournaments earlier. You know, KublaCon is also one that I would recommend people go to because it is a unique experience. You've got, like, trains of people that will walk around and yell and shout and encourage you to join in, and like that was the first time I saw that, like, naval ship game where you're playing on like a 12 foot by 15 foot like L-shaped
yes.
table.
Yes.
And you know, so yes. like it, again, for people that are like, hey, I want to go see different types of games and whatnot, you know, that's one. KublaCon is one that I always recommend because it's not just a wargaming, you know, there's other tabletop and D&D type things and all sorts of different war games that are, you know, very, very different from the ones that that we enjoy.
That's cool.
If it wasn't so much closer than Rocky Top Game Con, I think I probably would have paid you guys a visit because I do happen to have that weekend free. You guys picked a great weekend to do that, and it was totally open. But I was like, well, I could drive to this one.
Yeah, there's one right next door. Yep, yeah, so for Rocky Top, we're going to be maybe pushing. I'm trying to give some time for some other games to sell some tickets. If they don't, we may be pushing to 64. That is still on the table. But we are we sold out at 32. We raised the cap twice. We're sold out at 50. But yep, we're hoping to add some more seats, which means I need tables. So if you've got tables that you want to bring to Rocky Top, let me know. it's gonna be a fun challenge to overcome when we get back from Adepticon.
Cardboard terrain, hooray,
hooray!
It very well. I mean, we're gonna That's have fine. A tournament one way or another. After Rocky Top, we have Atlantic City, as we previously talked about, and then we have the American Team Classic, which is having a Legion event, maybe? There are ticket sales for a Legion event. I'm assuming our good buddy Josh is doing it. I haven't gotten any tons of info on it, but it is down at Dicehead Games, or near them, their big tournament. So I do want to support them. They've been really good to us, giving us free monthly tournaments. Like, there's something for that.
Yeah,
and then the summer will get closed out with Lone Star. That sounds like Tim is going to.
I am again Saturday Heat. Thank you.
I wanted to go, but it's the weekend before Gen Con.
That's my it's my weekend.
Yeah, I'm not thinking about that.
I take a whole week off of work for Gen Con, so because that is my favorite con of the year. So I can't quite squeeze Lone Star in there. But yeah, we got lots of big events for just about every month of the year going through August.
I'll be going to SoCal once we get all the way through to October, you know.
I'm excited that you're coming to SoCal. I'm going to do my best to make it back. It's at a weekend where there's not a whole lot else going on, and I don't tend to take time at the holidays. So end of October is usually pretty good for me.
Yeah.
So that'll be fun. That's the event.
Mail call.
We just got a letter.
We got mail, and this time it's not about a skirmish format or
it's
a weird
not
like
skirmish.
432 point whatever the hell that is.
Hey, we had a great discussion about 342 point Legion and how you can basically fit a functioning skirmish list for droids in there.
Oh my god.
It's five activations.
Dear STABcast, I'm a new player, and I started around Christmas and have played 4 or 5 800-point games so far.
Same as Ben.
I really want to get Obi-Wan into a list, but I'm struggling to figure out how to build it. This is my most desperate hour. Help me play Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're my only hope. May the Force be with you, Matt, also known as Jedi Merc, in the Discord.
Ah, Matt, you have chosen well.
That's you, Will. It's all you.
Obi-Wan is wonderful.
Yeah, you're the Obi-Wan player here. Yep.
Yes. I'll sit up here.
Do you remember how to play Obi-Wan? Because it's been a minute.
I'll never. It's like a bike. I can never forget. The secret for Obi-Wan is that he seems like a defensive guardian piece, but if you only do that, you won't get enough value out of him. You have to know when to YOLO Obi-Wan.
Because when you do, he has all the tokens and then doesn't die.
Hello there, like, it's disgusting if you do it right and get a bunch of enemies in range 2 and just stand there and say, hello there.
You do have to practice that pronunciation, by the way. You have to make it sound as much like the actual movie as you can when you say it out loud.
Hello there.
There you go.
Yeah.
There you go.
I'd recommend a list I've talked about on the show, and since you put your Discord, I will DM it to you as well. I ran it at LSO last year. It's Obi-Wan, a bunch of phase ones, and then a Flamer RT and an Ion Bark. And it basically makes your opponent look at Obi-Wan and your two supports and say, which of those am I going to kill? Because they're all a problem. So it's really fun to kind of come at from different directions. You know, you've got the Ion that can mess with vehicles. You've got a Flamer that scares droid players. I really enjoyed playing it.
Your LSO list had a couple places where you almost won that game.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, like you had a couple of games that are just so close. The list is good.
Yeah, in practice, it did pretty well. At LSO, I think I won and two'd, but they were all, you know, down to the last roll kind of things. So I wasn't mad about that.
Yeah.
And it, you know, it's Clone Commander and then a bunch, it's three DC-15, so you just have some really reliable dice. You don't have to make any, like, token stacks to get Z6s to work right. But whenever you do play that Obi-Wan 3 pip, you're still just sitting on so many surges, you can just keep them for defense because you don't have those Z6 die pools that you just roll four surge results and say, okay.
There's something to be said, too, I think, for... I've not tried it yet, but it's on my to-try list, on that huge list of things I want to try.
Right.
I think Obi-Wan and Wookiees has some play, but that's just my idea.
Potentially.
Potentially.
I get uncomfortable at 8x, Tim. I really do.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I would push it to 9 somehow. I'd find some way. I had it saved. I probably deleted it. I don't know. I probably made it when I was drunk and then deleted it when I was also drunk some other time. So I don't know.
If you're working on your own Obi-Wan, I would say Barrier Push Vigilance Tenacity is just a very solid build. You know, it just saves those dodges up. And then Barrier is amazing. Push is useful for when you're actually dueling stuff because you do need to get in there and start whacking people.
You should just bring Force Push. Like,
I mean, that's...
doesn't matter. That's
he's played four games. Imagine. We're getting there, okay?
I understand, but that's why we're saying it now. Say it now, get it now, because it's just then, always attach 10 points to your Jedi. That's whatever Force you should bring.
Using Guardian to take one wound and then having Tenacity available takes his die pool to way better odds, because the double rainbow is good, but once you get that third red die, it's like, oh, we're just a murder machine now.
It's
just getting practice with the hello there standby. When you can get that going really well, you can really mess with some people. So
just kind of on a practical note for that, I imagine the way it works is just basically the first turn that you as Obi-Wan start a round engaged with someone else, that's the hello there turn. You're never going to drop it when Obi-Wan's not engaged with somebody.
Not necessarily.
You probably want to get it. Oh, okay. What are some other viable times to play? Because that's the only time like I've ever been scared of that card, is on that first initial. Like, he dives at the end of one turn, gets engaged with something, Force pulls it into base with him, and then starts the hello there.
That's also...
like that's...
yeah, that is the optimal thing to do with it, yes.
As a new player, that's the situation you want to engineer, though.
Yes. You want to play his 2-pip for a bunch of dodges and then double move towards the enemy, hopefully getting close enough to Force Push someone in, even without the charge, just get them into melee. And then you play the hello there, stand there with your standby, they activate anything else. That's the other thing. You play hello there and you don't activate Obi-Wan. You do something else if you're going first. You just wait, and then they activate something.
You sit and wait.
It does anything. Even if that squad they're engaged with withdraws, you can still stand by, move back into them, charge, attack, you know, do whatever you want. And then you start blending them. Hello there is the reason I don't do stance on him, because it feels bad.
Will it blend?
Will it blend? Yes. Don't breathe that.
That is the question.
Don't breathe now, this.
Will, you make some very cogent points here. But our buddy Jan from the Philippines, STABcast the number one podcast of all time.
No, no, no.
Let me get my seatbelt.
No.
He recommends this bro bomb list, which is two lats carrying Anakin and Obi-Wan in four phase ones.
I love that so much.
Lats with just onboard comms. No,
no ordnance. No, that's what
no ordnance. It's just, you know, it's that scene. Ride of the Valkyrie starts playing. Two Jedi pop out. Blend, 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 blend. Phase ones go to grab boxes,
I
guess.
Could you also read his preamble here?
Please stop running and screaming. I swear there aren't any 7-act list here. I'm going to wait to 2023 for my next shot.
Just play Yanni. Just play Yanni. It's fun. Just do that instead.
Oh,
oh
God.
There you go.
Disagree. Listen, Jan, we always love it when you send us a list. You know that. Yeah, so please do. Please keep doing.
Mm-hmm. Mainly, we just like to send them to Tim and watch the reaction.
I see it. Let's go. No, please no.
Our Matt, Will send you his list. I will send you the list that Jan sent us so you can see it and contemplate it. You know what? Worst come to worst, it will be a fun thing talked about at many other parties later. So.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. If you really have faith in your Jedi play, I could see you maybe making this list work. I mean, there's something to be said for Double Force Push, but I think that's about all it's got going for it. It's about it.
But I mean, is this a thing? It is a thing.
It's a thing.
It's something that exist. It's you are there. Correct.
So, Will you bring Double Lats and Obi-Wan and Anakin to Adepticon?
No.
Do it, you coward.
No, I'll bring something even sillier.
Oh, God.
Because you're right about Double Heavy being in my Adepticon list.
Ooh.
Oh.
But a slightly different Double Heavy.
Indeed.
So, two tanks.
No, I mean, not Double Saber.
They're kind of tanks.
They're more of, you know, airboats.
Tank light.
Yeah,
swamp speeders
coming down from the bayou.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I saw these assembled for the first time last night. They are the weirdest model.
They are.
They're so fun.
They're so much fun, but they're so weird.
Except for those weird points of contact on the front shielding. It's so weird.
Yeah, those front plates only having those little five. Like,
why is this heavy piece of plastic held on by these few select, very skinny, small points? Yep. I don't understand.
So I've been playing a couple of practice games with Brett. We played one last night and then one a couple Wednesdays ago. And I will say, Tim is going to be an expert at these things because I think they suffer from the same problem the Gav does. They're just not quite tall enough for a lot of the terrain we're going to see. They don't get to just zip-zop and zoop over everything.
But they can hover. They hover and they strafe.
They hover.
And strafe. Yeah. They can strafe at speed 2.
And I think they're actually taller than the Gav tank.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah.
Yeah, but they're still shorter than a lot of the terrain that we frequently see. And since they don't have the speeder keyword.
They have hover.
Yeah, but they can only pass over things up to their height.
Okay. They're fine. They're fine.
Yeah, I think
they're
okay.
All right.
That big old base.
Yeah.
And remember, it strafes at speed 2, not speed 3.
I like this.
Or not speed 1. Like, it has a giant,
I like this list a lot.
So, give us a list.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, absolutely.
We have a clone commander with improv, an R2-D2 with nothing, two phase 1s with a Z6, two phase 1s with a RPS-6, two ATRTs with flamer and hacked comms, and two infantry support platforms with the Star Core pilots and missile pods for 10 activations.
Team missile pod, all right. I like it.
I figured I had anti-infantry from flamethrowers, so I wanted the impact. And then...
Yeah, if you come up against an armor list, you're gonna, with two RPSs and then the two twin missile pods, plus the ATRTs aren't terrible.
No, they've got the bloop 2 and the impact 1.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the Z6s, you can get some crits off that.
Well, especially if I fire support surge crit with the Star Core.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're gonna shred some armor lists. That's...
Yeah, you are.
Yep. I am coming at those spider droids or whatever else.
Well, and now like the flame, you know, the flamethrowers for you is going to do great against all those droid spams and things like that. You're capturing an objective. Be a real shame if you all just died instantly.
Right.
Listen, it's what happened to me twice the last time I played Will against flamethrowers.
I named the list Ion Me Please, but I'm hoping that there's too much. It's like target saturation. Those spider droids have to pick something. And then the rest will still be able to do their job.
And and you've also got like a soft answer to Ion. Like, remember out there, folks, R2-D2 can remove Ion tokens.
He can remove two Ions with one action, yes.
That's true.
Yeah. So, like, obviously that's not what you want to be doing, but if it's going to activate your flamethrower, it's the thing you absolutely do.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's fair.
Honestly, as a spider ion guy, I'm just going to be like, you know what? Let's kill R2-D2.
Yeah.
He's hiding behind
win,
a corner.
Damn it.
Near enough to the ATRT.
Are we in any kind of waffle territory? Have you gotten many reps with this for Adepticon?
I'm pretty locked in. I've not submitted it, but I don't feel like I'm going to change it very much.
Yeah.
I might change some of these battle cards. I think we talked about swapping major offensive to rollout, perhaps.
Yeah, I definitely think with four vehicles in your list, you definitely want rollout that offers you flexibility that rollout may not
then,
offer.
Yes, rollout deployment rollout. And then scouting ATRTs yes, is pretty cool.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
Especially with flamers.
Real good. Oh, yeah, yeah. It is. The flamethrower is basically there already. That's amazing.
The only thing I don't love is command cards are a little, you know, like I don't have a...
Sure.
I have clone generics and then a couple R2 cards.
Come on, take R2's flamer, so that way you can have three flamers in your list.
No.
Yeah, I know there's, actually, looking at this list, I know there's just a ton of utility in it, but I'm actually a little surprised to see Smokescreen here over Generic Assault.
I think because the Wiggles could come in handy.
I mean, well, that's why I said it's a lot of utility. Yeah. I wonder if you want the control and the orders because, oh, cool, yeah. I've given out three orders and my clone commander, and now all my fire supports are up for my phase ones.
True. Yeah.
So for me, Will, I only really like Smokescreen if I've got the points for a relay on R2 so he can pass both of his tokens.
I mean, a free mover, he doesn't get the speed. Right?
Well, he doesn't get to move himself. It's when he orders another unit.
Ah, so it's just the mm-hmm. other. Okay.
It's just the other unit.
Yeah, it's not a free scoot for him. It's for the other unit. So if you got somebody that you want to like peekaboo or get into a good position, it still can definitely do some work. But
it's good for the cumbersome rocket squads because they can get that free move and then still have an token to fire support
right.
or do
oh,
whatever.
That's right. Your rockets are cumbersome.
Yes, they are, Ben. Yeah. You asshole.
What kind of a weakling would have that?
Too bad you don't have these robot arms. Ugh. Flex.
Yeah.
Robot arms. How many robot RPSs are you even bringing, Ben? All of them?
None, because he doesn't need to. There's a thing called an E5S.
I'm in fact not bringing any. So here's what I'm bringing to this, because I promised you last episode I was bringing two snail tanks, and by God, I am.
Yeah, but that I also puts the us... double snail expert on to critique your list.
Well, so now he actually has me rethinking from the first part of this episode, because, you know, LJ was talking about playing his as long rangers. So, like, you're just going to sit in the back, do a lot of damage at range 4. I'm currently set up for the engagement to the running in. So, mm-hmm. I have got the super tackle droid Kalani this time with strict orders and
right
vigilance.
Call. Absolutely, yeah.
Two snail tanks, both have defense protocols, onboard comm channels, high energy shells. I'm going to put in those tanks two B2 super battle droids with Haas and an extra body. I'm not going with the T-Series. Then two B1s with the E5Ss, and then two naked B1s, because I ran out of points.
Yep, that'll happen.
No, looking at this, I think that you've got your snail tanks equipped for what you want to do, because I assume you're loading up the B2s in the snails, that's why you got onboard comms. So, you know, you've got the defense protocols instead of the engagement or the attack, which, honestly, I totally understand. I don't think that's a bad move at all. Really looking at this, the one thing that kind of threw me off was just, I don't know if you love your control that your command hand offers. I think that's maybe one of the weaknesses that, it's super easy to fall into with the tactical droids is I ended up shedding in my gun line that I'm playing right now, which is 5B1s, two spiders, a snail, a magna, and Kalani. I shed orbital strike and they too will suffer because it's just, you lose way too much control of your heavy hitters. And it's kind of fun because like I'll put Kalani in a position where it looks like he's going for a scope and he'll be like, you know, range 6 away looking at you across the board. And you're like, oh man, I gotta scoot this heavy out of the way because maybe he can see it. And he's going for the scope. And it's like, oh no, he's just scooting around and moving places and just being a general nuisance as he does. So like, that's when I look at this, that's kind of the one thing that sticks out to me is, you know, you've got your direct on Kalani. So you've always got an extra order in your back pocket, but I think either orbital strike for push or they too will suffer for ambush might actually be a play you should consider here.
So I was actually thinking the same thing because orbital strike does only offer the command token to the heavy, mm-hmm. which is nice, but I then can't use the orbital strike. Like it has to go through Kalani. Mm-hmm. He would hopefully be far enough back, but I'm with you. I would think I would rather get two guys with push. And I don't think I've ever played they too will suffer correctly. I mean, I've played it. I've done the thing. I don't know that I've ever made the right call for getting something to come out of a bag when I needed
So I love that card, but the last time I played it, it was like, it did nothing. And I knew it did nothing, but I had to play it. Because it was against a droid list. So like he already had perfect control. So I was like, oh no, this has to go back in your bag. It's the only thing in your bag.
You definitely, it's not as flexible as like, you know, Dooku's mess with you card or Palpatine's mess with you card. You definitely have to engineer a situation. And it kind of falls into that category of, you know, what people like to call as a win more card. Because they've probably messed something up if you're playing this correctly. And then also, like, the thing that people take on Kalani when they bring this card is I noticed, you know, they like to bring that comms relay because the order has to go to Kalani.
Right.
And that's why in my Snail Double Spider, that's actually why I've been defaulting to ambush over They Too Will Suffer. Because then he can direct an order to one, give the ambush order to another, pop an HQ uplink down the line, and then my bag is, you know, Kalani or something else, and, you know, maybe a snail tank or a spider. Though half the time when I play that, one of the two spiders has already gone down, so it's like, cool, I don't need... That's the other thing, too. As a droid player, when I look at my command cards, I strive to get perfect order control every turn, but then again, depending on what you see your command card order being, you don't always need perfect order control every turn because you expect to take some sort of attrition. You just have to build that in your plan, because if you're not building that in your plan, then you tend to make mistakes later in your game.
Right.
And so that's something you could board up, I think.
There's part of me that wants to get rid of the E5Ss and go to the E5Cs because it gives me four more points to play with. And I know why Tim says that. I'm very much a believer. I want blue. I like my battle deck. Sure. I don't want to have to play bomb and run. I mean, I'm thinking about it, but I tanks
defense
I want to do other
protocol
things.
Snakes. I think you tanks. You'd be okay.
Snakes.
I'm not a super fan of payload with my snakes stuff here. I mean, it's doable. But the other thing is, I don't have an HQ uplink, which I am traditionally putting on those B1s, just because I can always run the line down to Kalani.
Having one. The thing that sticks out to me. You don't LJ need can probably net. Speak more to this. No commanding presence on Kalani.
So you had talked about it, I get it. So you can get the direct out.
Honestly, it's been a huge improvement to my Kalani list. Huh. Yes, that because it happens all the time. Kalani is giving support in one area. And then because, and this is very specific to the snail tank, because the snail tank moves like
so fast.
10, 11 inches with that move, it is very easy to be like, oh man, I am 21 inches away. I'm out of my 18 inch, you know, range 3 bubble. I'm now in range 4 and I cannot give an order anymore. And my order control is not what I want it to be.
And it bumps your range of direct because he's the one.
Yeah,
who's
no, that's
order. Yeah.
That's what I primarily use it for is that direct order, and that honestly, you need the space with the snail tank because it takes up so much room in your deployment zone. You need to have that space to kind of spread your list out, and it makes it so Kalani, who usually wants to be in a couple different places, doesn't necessarily need to be, you know, tied down to one spot. He can give those aim and those dodges in one location, but still be ordering the other half of your list. And like, I put it on him as kind of like, okay, well, when I'm playing a new thing, sometimes I will take, you know, cards players consider to be crutches, like commanding presence. That is totally, in a lot of people's eyes, a crutch card, because in theory you should need it unless you're playing something you think is going to outpace your army.
Sure.
But if I'm learning spatially how something fits on the board for the first time, I might take it because it's a good mistake eraser. You're like, oh, huh, I'm noting that I, you know, am not always in range to order that. That's a problem I need to fix in my gameplay.
That makes sense.
But when I started to use it in my snail tank list, I realized that it was a force multiplier. It wasn't a mistake eraser. Mm-hmm. It was, oh, now Kalani can be here standing next to my spider droids and giving them aims and dodges, but also we're directing the snail tank every turn. And that has been absolutely cash money recently.
And I think you'll be able to double down on it, that you have the onboard comms on your tank. So you can always direct the tank, which then directs a B2.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So that's something I would really heavily consider, maybe even over Vigilance, because how often are your B1s getting those dodge tokens?
It's the B2s.
I would take it over Strict Orders. I'm not actually 100% sure why you have that in this list.
I will say part of it's a hangover from all the other lists of play. I like battle B1s, not worrying about it at all, because they tend to get tokens tend to get order tokens. So why roll dice when you don't have to? Just boop, pull it off.
Yeah.
And so that way that it never builds up. Like it's always removing suppression pressure. I haven't had a B1 panic in some time, unless they were just outside the bubble.
Yeah. Yeah.
I could get to the commanding presence and an HQ if I really felt like I needed it, but I'd have to drop the high energy shells.
Yeah,
now,
I don't think you want to do that.
And see, I'm going to be rushing in. I could definitely get rid of Vigilance. It's only there because I had Kalani. So, that's honestly it. Because I was giving away tokens so often. If I don't spend it on a B2, why not keep it on the B2?
Okay, that's fair.
Is he going to be near enough the B2s, though, is my concern.
Yeah, I was going to say, when that B2's not in range, too, it's like, well, okay.
Yeah.
Right. Well, I guess the idea was also we're just going to run to catch up. Because I doubt I'll be shooting much with Kalani. And the tank should provide a pretty healthy amount of cover to stand behind it.
So just move, strategize.
Yeah, kind of. Actually, I don't know. I've never played Kalani. But if I'm not going to use all three command slots, then I may. And I like the direct, don't get me wrong. But Override does a lot of work for me, too.
I'll refer you to my previous games this YBTL season. I use one of his command slots.
Right. Yeah.
I have been using one of his command slots in all of the games I've played with the snail tank, and it has not really been that big of a deal. Something that is super, super weird, too, that you could maybe look at if you really wanted to, is you could drop the extra super battle droid down to a PK and save yourself a point. And then it's like, okay, cool. Is the PK fixing the persuader, which is getting ioned a lot these days, or is it fixing, you know, B2s and bringing that up? I mean, there's weird little things you could do to save the points. I like Kalani in this list. There would be a very, very corner case argument to be made to save the 5 points and go down to the generic, but I think Kalani definitely makes a lot of list per, so yeah. I don't think I'd default to that option. But yeah, I mean, I think there's ways to cut it, but at the end of the day, you know, you always gotta ask yourself, like, hey, what am I trying to do? What is my core component or, you know, objective that this list is trying to accomplish? And when I see this, it's like, cool, you've got Kalani delivering these two tanks and the B2s on board to glorious victory. That's my focus at all times, right? So as long as your choices meet that goal, I think you'll be, you know, moderately successful. I can't account for all of your plays. I will not take credit or blame you for any decisions you happen to make at Adepticon. Yeah. But I know you're going to look better than all the other droid players because of how nice that snail tank looks.
Oh, so nice. And I got to thank Will for that. Like, I really...
Eyebrows for advantage.
Uh-huh.
Eyebrows for advantage. Vigilance I can easily get rid of. I can't get rid of Strict. Strict is just so easy for gameplay purposes to not think about. I can easily get that to the points where I need it to be. So the B2, the extra body, was really just throwing those extra dice. Like, that's all they're there for. Like, it's just an extra black-white when you're rolling in. Because the PKs are non-combatants. So
yeah, more wounds, too. Yeah. This is the part where we would mock Tim's list for whatever faction pop he made.
I don't have Tim's one.
Tim got the tree faction.
couldn't figure out what to bring. Oh.
Yeah.
You had too many Wookiees in your tree.
If you don't bring an army, then you don't have to choose which faction you bring.
That's true.
Tapping the head meme.
Yeah.
Here.
Yeah.
There you go. So what'd you bring, Ryan?
Yeah, so I've been TOing a lot, and my effort has been, like, a lot of my Legion time has been going into that stuff, so I haven't had a time to practice a lot of the things I wanted to play. I did really want to bring Tawns to Adepticon, but I just haven't gotten enough times to, like, really figure that unit out, because I've never been a Tawn player. So I'm sticking with what I know, even though it may be a trap, and I'm staying with Flyboys. I've been playing Flyboys pretty consistently since December, so I've got a lot of reps under my belt.
I hope your list burns in a fire.
I will try.
This is the real reason Tim pulled out. So we've got Han with the way I always take him with. I swapped, because my bag's a little more consistent, I swapped improv orders for Vigilance, then duck and cover, and this list has Recon Intel that I posted, but it's supposed to be E-Gear.
I was about to say, okay, no, E-Gear makes much more sense.
Yeah, it's always E-Gear. And then Luke with Push, Burst of Speed, Seize the Initiative for the Han Zero pip. I'm a little torn on what my second force power needs to, or my third force power needs to be, and I'll talk about that, I guess, in a second. And then I've got three vets, three Mark IIs, all three vets have the heavies, Biston, and a sniper strike team for 10 activations and a 3-point bid. I don't know if I have enough impact. I have a lot. Actually, I have like zero impact outside of Biston. I have a lot of critical. Do I take force reflexes, which is my comfort pick to keep Luke alive, or do I take saber throw for an extra anti-armor ranged poke?
Ooh, I think you take saber throw, especially when you can fire support with the Mark IIs for a little added extra oomph.
Mm-hmm. Yep. I
don't know. That would be where I'd go.
I have seen T-47s come down with the saber strike that's been fire supported.
You know, Luke has charge instead of relentless, so I hate actually taking the attack action, but it gives me a little extra impact onto speeders or tanks that I can't quite get to. Burst of speed will cover most of the territory I think I need saber throw for. But saber throw also gives me the added benefit of if Luke's first attack cleaves through whatever I'm Son of Skywalkering, I can always saber throw as a backup.
Yeah.
I can also mess with my core. I'm not quite settled on whether I want three Mark IIs and three vets. I can change my core around a little bit to get two ion troopers. I can get two fleet troopers and a bigger bid, I think, with some heavies. I don't have an HQ on Biston, which I generally like to have. I just don't have the points for. So I'm a little flippy floppy on what my core options are going to be, but after playing a game with Brett the other night where I ran double vet with heavies and Mark IIs and Cassian, like the gun line fire support is not something I traditionally like to play, but man, it just cleared his clones when they didn't roll any saves.
Mm-hmm. So I do want to thank Brett for this conversation because he and I have been working on you for 2 years these Mark IIs. And you finally accepted them to be a veteran.
Yeah. Well, and you guys have known me long enough. Like, the way that I like to understand an argument is whatever anyone tells me, I'm going to take the opposite approach to try to figure it out. That's just how my brain works. Like, to figure, I need to argue something to understand it. So, I don't know. Part of me wants to take two Rebel Ion Troopers just so I have triple Ion on my list and can really spook some people. But I think the extra Mark II, like, the fact that everything in this list, I have two activations that don't either surge crit or have critical something. And now I do complain about critical and think it's a rough keyword, but I might as well use it if it's going to be there. So the other thing I don't know what my command hand looks like. I really don't.
Yeah.
Obviously, I'm taking Sorry About the Mess. I don't think I'm taking Han's 2 pip because I don't have anything that trades super well and I don't want them shooting my Luke over and over and over and over again.
Right.
So I think I'm taking both of Luke's twos. There's three good options for three pips. So I don't know which three pip to drop. And I think go ahead.
After seeing and playing against some more operative Luke's this past season, I think one of the most annoying mind games that has been played with me, and this is what I was playing, of course, Dooku Maul, new mm-hmm. Double the Fall, is the threat of I Am a Jedi existing is greater a lot of times than the plays it actually opens up. I think you can get away with cutting I Am a Jedi, especially if you end up getting rid of Force Reflexes for Saber Throw. I would definitely keep Return of the Jedi.
Return of the Jedi is also there to set up fire supports. Like it's a three pip that actually orders a bunch of things.
It's a big enabler, and I think I think I Am a Jedi is if you're considering a cut, you cut it, you accept it, and you move on with your life and bring Han's three pip.
Can the same argument not get paid for change of plans that just the threat of it being there can create some shenanigans?
I think with Yoda existing, you don't want the threat of the counter. You want the counter.
That's fair.
Yeah. I think you can you can get away with the threat of I Am a Jedi, but again, with the way that you know, it messes with people's command hands with the fact that people still aren't familiar with fighting on, because it takes so long for the Legion community to like catch up to changes and get games in and get that get those reps in. Honestly, I think that factor alone will be more valuable than what you get out of I Am a Jedi.
That's fair. My other concern for I Am a Jedi, and like I said, I figure things out by arguing for them. This list, I don't think, other than Luke, like the melee skew, the double triple Magna, the double triple Wookiees, that is so good at just turning them off to where Luke can go mess and do with other things. Because if big melee threats hit my relatively fragile gun line, that spooks me. But if right before those Magnas crash in, I can just say, hey, nah, bros, you aren't going to attack. That seems to have some value for me. I don't know. This is something I will waffle on until the deadline.
Yep. Until you get out the door. But there is a list lock, though.
There is a list
lock. You got to make up your mind at some point.
And then Riot will show up and it'll be like, oh, no, wait, I'm judging and streaming the whole time. I don't know what you're talking about.
No, I'll just take the hard warning. It's fine.
Yeah, so. You will.
But yeah, that's my list. It's a lot of stuff I'm really comfortable with. Biston, Han, Luke. I have to take Biston. I'm contractually obligated at this point.
Biston's a thing.
Biston is a thing. I was sad. My goal for Yavin Base this year was at least one team, and I thought it was maybe going to be you guys. I was like, I need someone to veto Pathfinders against me and during the ban phase.
Yeah, like, I get why y'all vetoed what you vetoed the last time, but I felt that was possibly a bad call.
Ryan just wants someone to care. That's all.
It's true.
I definitely made the joke when I was talking to some teammates, and I did have a Nick Bodnar cursed me out last night because I advocated for banning Maul. And he was like, I've played every game of the season with Maul and won all these games with Maul, and you took him away from me. And I was like, I want him to know it was me.
Oh, man.
But I'm just not playing in the Legion main event, because Thursday night I'm playing Skirmish. Oh, God. So if we want to go through my Skirmish list and get some feedback on that.
No, absolutely not. No. So no? I got this one.
Nope. 400 point Legion.
No, let's go. So let's when Ryan and now 52. LJ. No, when Ryan and now also LJ, and Ryan ropes LJ into building crappy Skirmish lists that aren't even full Skirmish points and just random point totals, that's time for us to call it quits before Tim has a stroke. So, as always, thank you for listening with your drive time, paint time, whatever time. You're hopefully driving to Adepticon right now. Drive safe. Watch your
Ben
watch
and
your
I
weather.
Are as you listen.
Yeah, we are. Actually.
There you go. I'm Tim Hennon, and I'm reminding you that you don't have to play if you don't want to, but it's okay. Your friends will just make fun of you for a long time.
Oh, it's true. It's true. Ryan Slowski reminding you that you should fear the boogeyman of all my critical and Pierce. I've succumbed. I can't believe I've succumbed to critical. I'm sorry, everyone.
I'm LJ Pena, and I'm reminding you that the snail tank is taller than you think. Ooh. And faster than you assume.
True. Yeah, true.
I'm Will Heim, reminding you to check the bottom of the Adepticon event for my ISP list after it's over. Thank you.
I think you'll win a game.
And I'm Ben Fowler, reminding you, these two boys here, Gary and Larry, are bringing it to you, Adepticon. Prepare yourself.
The eyebrows are coming. Good night, everyone.
Good night, everybody.
Good night, everybody.
You know I'm going to lick my two fingers and then spread those eyebrows.
Ben was practicing stroking the eyebrows last night. Like,
the bullhorn.
As soon as you need to have Larry die first, so you can just be petting him like a cat, like in your head, like a supervillain. Just like, yes, this is Gary.
That's right. Or Larry. That's right, Larry. We'll watch Gary win this battle.